Real Chat Episode 38, Star Wars Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back.
The Empire has been repulsed, but this one defeat will increase its determination to crush the rebellion once and for all. In the continuation of the Star Wars saga, the Empire strikes back, and Luke, Han, and Princess Leia must confront its awesome might. In the course of the Odyssey, they travel with their faithful friends, droids and Wookiees, to exotic worlds where they meet new alien creatures and evil machines. Culminating in an awesome confrontation between Luke Skywalker and the master of the dark side of the Force, Darth Vader. Luke Skywalker, Princess Leia, Han Solo, C-3PO, R2-D2, Chewbacca, and introducing Lando Calrissian. In the continuation of the Star Wars saga, the Empire Strikes Back.
A long time ago in a galaxy far, far away. Everybody, welcome to episode 38 of Real Chat, a podcast that promises week in, week out, the real world as we know it. Today, Real Chat is undertaking what is most likely our second most ambitious retrospective review so far. How on earth do you justifiably dissect, analyze, and freshen up the most popular entry to one of the most beloved hit movie franchises of all time? And when it comes to extreme movie fandom, there simply is no bigger franchise than George Lucas's Star Wars. And what an important year it is for the franchise, with practically every sci-fi and movie fan in the world anticipating its seventh entry in December this year. Today, Real Chat is retrospectively focusing our attention on the hit second entry of the all-conquering Star Wars franchise, 1980s, Star Wars Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back. Pause for breath. My name is Adam Stolfo, and this is my favourite Star Wars movie for many, many reasons, which we're going to get into why. And I'm joined here, as usual, by co-host Brose Avard. Brose, we're finally returning to Star Wars.
Yeah, it's been a while. There's been a few false starts. We've had a few times we planned to look at it, but
April was when we looked at episode 4.
Wow. So there's a good chance between now and the seventh entry, which is also the name of one of my favourite porn films. There's a good chance that we'll be rushing through some of the Star Wars films between now and then. But that should be good. I mean, this was my favourite Star Wars film for a long time, and it probably still edges out my second favourite, but we'll talk about some of that later on.
Mm. Welcome back as well, Mr. Andrew McCaskill. How are you, sir?
Very, very well, thank you. Very well. Yeah, very much excited to talk about this one as well. It's right up there with one of the great films.
Yeah, I think it's worth pointing out Andrew's come in theme tonight. He's dressed as a young George Lucas with a beard.
And the beard?
And the check shirt.
This is the second time you've done that, yeah. And it seems to be... It's a tradition now.
Did I do that in the Star Wars episode as well?
I expect more in Return of the Jedi.
There you go. I'm dressed as Yoda, and I've got Frank Oz's hand up my ass. So, we're all in theme. We're all in theme today.
It's not a bad thing. I know how much of a fan you are of Frank Oz. And... as well, we have a special guest with us today. It's Mark Horpinitch. I hope I pronounced that correctly.
Absolutely perfect.
Fantastic. First go.
It's good to be here.
Mark, welcome to Real Chat.
Thank you very much.
Yes, big Star Wars fan. Is that right, Mark?
I don't know anyone who isn't. Yeah, I'm a big nut. And one of the things about the movie that all of us can enjoy is that because it is coming back, it's the best thing as a Star Wars fan. If you were there originally and you saw it, go back, watch them all. But Empire's still the best.
So just quickly, Mark, of the six existing films, how many have you seen in the cinema?
All of them.
All six of them?
Yeah, all six.
That's impressive.
Yeah, so I've seen all six, and then when they were reversion, also saw...
The re-releases from 97
as well, yeah.
And onwards. Because Toby Truslove was on Star Wars A New Hope.
He was.
Saw Empire and Jedi in the cinema, so he'd seen five of the six from memory, but six out of six. That's our first six out of six. That's
how older than I look.
How old were you when you saw the first... Star Wars.
Well, what was that?
Is this giving away?
77.
77. So I was 8.
Ah, nice.
Yes.
Good age.
Yeah, perfect. Yeah,
perfect age for it.
I saw it about 2 times in about 4 weeks because all the kids were in primary school. We went crazy. It was great. It was awesome. It was nothing like it. In fact, one of the things that stands out is many cinemas didn't have stereo sound.
Oh, and, so you're listening
Lucas,
to it in mono.
Yeah, so Luke, you know, a lot of cinemas here in Melbourne were mono, and Lucas insisted it had to be stereo, so it was an uproar, but yeah. Cinemas got upgraded as a result.
And I think this one we're looking at, Brose, Empire Strikes Back, I think is the first film to be in the multi-channel 5.1, I think, as well.
Oh, wow, as a cinematic release.
As a cinematic release,
wow, that's impressive.
Yeah. So just quickly, for those of you who don't know your good self, Mark, you're a television director for Channel 10, who is known for your work on the hit show The Project, working alongside our very own Brose Avard, of course.
We do.
That's true. That's quite often Mark's job to, well, not talking directly to me, but through the floor manager, basically telling me to shut up. So there may be points during today's podcast where Mark tells Adam to tell me to shut up because... He obviously can't tell me directly.
Through the that's right.
Gotcha. It's very rude. I might do it, I promise.
And you've also done other stints on other well-known Australian television productions on both the 9 and 10 networks.
Yeah.
Including Who Wants to Be a Millionaire?
Yes.
The Circle?
Yes.
And the Evening News for both the 10 and 9 networks?
Yeah,
is that
and
correct?
Also throw Channel 7 in there, but it's not about me.
Nice. Yeah, I can't believe I missed that one out. Yeah. And most interestingly for myself as well, being a huge AFL fan, apparently you directed two episodes of a show in 2011 called Simply Footy.
Oh, my God.
Mark's, is that taking you back?
Mark's blocked
Simply
that out of
Footy,
his memory.
Simply Footy, that was an Adelaide show, wasn't it?
I think so.
Yeah, where'd you get that from? And what was the show about? Was it... It was
well, they covered different recipes and cooking. They'd also cover hot spots to go out and visit in town and a shitload of football.
I think, yeah, because it was an AFL show coming from Adelaide, I'd only focus on two football teams. Oh, it's not a career highlight.
Tony Modro, isn't he great?
Yeah. Is that why there are only two episodes? Because it was just when the Crows played Port Adelaide each
year? I think maybe someone put that on IMDb just as a bit of a gag, did they? Yeah.
Shits and giggles.
It's worked.
Wait, is this factual information? Or
it is.
It is, actually.
You just tried to forget it.
Now, just quickly, Brose, a bit of social media feedback, which is our latest segment.
Oh, we got some more.
Yeah.
God, look at
now,
you.
Now, the first one I've put in is because we're doing a Star Wars episode here. Now, a fellow by the name of Nathan Jones of Melbourne indie band New Birds.
Nice.
Wrote to us saying, my son wants to know if you're going to be doing episodes 1, 2, and 3 of Star Wars.
Well, this is one of the interesting things, and I think we talked about this, Mark, the other day when we were talking about Star Wars. One of the things I'm excited about when we get to the prequels, and we might even have to dig up a guest for those that fits into this category, there is a whole bunch of kids who didn't grow up with the films like we did, and the prequels are Star Wars to them. Mm. As they get older, as they get into teenagerhood and then later on, they have a bigger appreciation and enjoyment for those films that we simply don't have. So that's a perspective I'm really keen to discuss and have a look at when we get to the prequels, because there is more and more support for those films from that particular generation that don't know any better. But yeah, it's kind of cool.
I've got a message for Nathan Jones as well. We don't let three-year-olds dictate what we do on Real Chat, so you know, take that.
Yeah, I don't know how it works in his house, but around here, we do what we want to when Adam tells us we can.
We need to say that we were always going to look at the three prequels, but we were actually going to demote them all into like one episode.
We were.
Now we've expanded that and they are getting their own episode.
They're
because we
get
do
the right
feel
treatment.
That this year, like we, I think we should be looking at them all in the lead up to the new one.
Absolutely.
At the end of the year. So,
and you're a masochist as well, so that's nice. Yeah. That's,
you know what?
Great.
One of them could get my lowest score in
ever.
The history of this show.
And when it comes to unfavourable prequels, we can expect Andrew not to be here. So...
Consider it done.
He'll be ghosting. I just gave you an out there. You're fine. You don't have to turn up. No Jar Jar Binks for you, son.
Now, Brose, our big fan from Chicago, Mindy Laff, who we spoke about
a couple of weeks ago on
the High Fidelity episode, wrote to us again, said, I'll be in LA next week for Podcast Fest. I'll make sure to spread the word about Real Chat. I believe your country mate, Will Anderson, will be there.
Oh, good mate,
big
Will.
Comedian here
who
in
has two of his own podcasts, Philosophy and Tofop. So check those out on iTunes.
I've also been meaning to send you an email about my Michael J. Fox encounter 30 years ago. You know, the Back to the Future ding guy.
My question there is, are you going to still put a ding in for Back to the Future, or are you going to let her ding be the ding for Back to the Future? And the three times I've just mentioned Back to the Future, do they get their own dings as well? Or
about to find out.
We're about to find out.
When you listen back to
when
the
I listen back to this.
That's right. All the best from Chicago. So yeah, Mindy Laff. Was,
oh, that's exciting. So she hasn't told us about her encounter with Michael J. Fox
no,
yet?
No, I think she might be saving it for the Back to the Future
wow.
episode coming
I look
up,
forward
bro,
to it. So. She's our most prolific feedbacker so far.
Except for Lisa Lilly also from
oh,
Chicago.
Oh, wow, back again.
I'm halfway through the discussion of T3, which I watched years ago and completely forgot. Go figure.
Yeah, Schwarzenegger tried to forget it. A lot of people have tried to forget that film.
Terminator Salvation may not be worth watching, but Real Chat Podcast hits all the low and high points perfectly. The Batman voice from John Connor really bugged me too.
Oh, it's so annoying. It's a combination between angry and constipation. I just can't. It's too much. It's too much.
And just a couple of comments from iTunes as well. The very first one, just check it out, guys and girls. A real joy.
Hey.
I like it.
Nice, bit of pun.
Nice work.
This is great. The guy called Andrew, he makes me wet.
What? What in what way? What do you mean? What is that?
That is on iTunes, bro. That's weird. On iTunes.
The only way I can make sense of that in my mind is that when I spend time with Andrew, I need to shower afterwards. Is that what you're talking about?
And is the name Matthew O'Neill? Is that
Matt's review?
It stinks a lot of Matthew O'Neill, I reckon.
It was under an alias.
I don't know for truth. He does feel that way anyway. Yeah. But
and more serious one as well. Not your typical movie review podcast. This shines because of its focus on one film and its history, cultural significance, trivia, and behind the scenes info. The hosts rarely go off topic and really put you in the mood to revisit some of these classics.
Wow, this was written better than we say it.
I thought so. Yeah,
it's nice. We
very
have to steal that.
Very nice review.
Makes us sound more intelligent than I thought we were too.
And just quickly, an email I just had to come back to because we've only just started this segment, of course, bros, from June. Guys, great episode. Almost. Where was the soul of your podcast? Where was Andrew McCaskill? You must have felt adrift with him. I know my ears did. Good work overall, but please, more Andrew. And that came from David Gutierrez. Do you know this person, Andrew?
Look, I might have walked past him, you know, once or twice in life.
Andrew, are you David Gutierrez? I think that's the question, everybody. And are we pronouncing it correctly?
Andrew being absent on the odd episode, David has taken, you know.
Wow, taken exception.
He's just a man with good taste. Yeah. That's all he is.
Well, that's good to know. I'm going to have to start making up feedback for me. I'm feeling left out.
Now, this is an episode of our Vintage Vault retrospective series, a conscious effort to tie in selected shows with something of relevance to the present. This year, of course, it's Empire Strikes Back 35-year anniversary this year. But, of course, I'm sure you'll all agree that there's no bigger year to look back at the Star Wars saga with Episode 7, The Force Awakens, opening in December. Undoubtedly one of the most anticipated movies of all time, especially in light of Disney acquiring the franchise rights and promising not only a third trilogy, but a bunch of Star Wars spin-off films as well. So, tell you what, over the next 15 to 20 years, we can foresee a lot more Star Wars coming our way, that's for sure.
It sounds like an endless flow is about to...
Are you excited by that?
I'm really, really excited. I just want the hype to... live up to the hype, rather, yeah. Because, yeah. I mean, it's Disney. There's going to be show bags. You know, it's just bells and whistles, theme parks. I hope that everything is as exciting so we're not just getting, you know, sort of Star Wars fatigue in about 2 years.
Are you right into the hype? Are you kind of getting into it, or are you just keeping a distance from it?
I think I'm going to be drawn in. I've got two young kids, two boys, and well aware of Star Wars, and they love it. So I think I'm just going to be drawn into the flow with them. So I've got no escape.
Is it just me? It seems quiet. It seems, considering there's a new Star Wars film about to come out in months.
It feels like the calm before the storm to me.
Yeah,
like
there seemed to be a lot of buzz a few months ago. Yeah, maybe you're right. I mean, I'm now on a Star Wars blackout for the new film. I'm not looking at any stories. I'm not looking at any footage, behind-the-scenes footage, no more previews. I'm just whitewalling. I did get a little bit excited about, is it B-88? What's the name of that new droid?
BB-8.
BB-8? Oh, that toy was pretty exciting. But I'm just distancing myself from all that to try and be fresh when I go in, because I was well and truly sucked into Phantom Menace and went a little bit crazy. I still have about 73 Phantom Menace action figures that are worth literally $0 right now. So, but, you know, if you're getting married and you want Star Wars cake toppers, let me know. I think that's the only use there is for them. But yeah, I think the buzz has dropped a little bit, but I think it'll pick up again. I think it's going to...
Are we getting another trailer, do you think, before it was released?
Yeah,
there will be.
Oh, there will?
Yep, there's another trailer.
I'm going to ask you guys just quickly to list as many things as possible that we all take for granted as being integral to the series as a whole, which didn't come along until this second movie. So much of what people consider Star Wars to be is first shown to us here in The Empire Strikes Back. What are some of the things that jump to mind, guys? Key things with the Star Wars lore.
Oh, geez, you've stumped us straight off the bat.
I'll start it going for you. The Imperial March.
Right. Yeah. Okay, this is the first time it's used. Okay.
Yep.
Yeah, we discussed a little bit in the first Star Wars film that Darth Vader in the first film is kind of like a bodyguard. He just kind of follows around. He's a bit of a goon. He's kind of a henchman. Whereas he really comes into his own in this film as well, and it's the badass Darth Vader that we're all waiting for, I think, which is great.
Another one, Yoda, or Yoda's theme, which is another piece of music which is very famous from the series. And with Yoda comes a deeper understanding of the Force, which comes with him.
Yep.
So that wasn't introduced until this one as well. Using the Force to control objects.
Yeah, the pulling the lightsaber into his hand right at the start of the film and things like
nothing like that.
That's new in this film.
Yep. Nothing like that in New Hope.
Yeah, Irvin Kershner talks about in the commentary how great he loved that particular thing because they were really easy special effects to do on set. It's like, all you need is a bit of string. It's my favorite type of effect. It's free.
Seeing the Emperor mentioned in A New Hope, but not yet a character.
Yeah, right. You know?
I think people completely forget sometimes about how much was
implied in the first film and how much is seen in this one.
Bounty hunters?
Yeah, well, bounty hunters were apparently supposed to play a bigger part in the first Star Wars film, but then Lucas changed his mind or he wrote them out, but then introduced them in a big way in this film.
Incredible stunts from the Millennium Falcon.
Yeah, I think that's true, actually. A lot of they got more adventurous with all of the effects. I don't know if the budget was any bigger for Empire or not.
We're about to get into that shortly. Yeah. It's a little bit bigger.
Well, there is there was all that discussion about how Lucas was on location filming the first Star Wars film and he left the ILM guys back in LA to work on the effects and he came back 6 months later and they'd done zero work. And I think also with Star Wars, a lot of the money and time was spent developing the technology, building the robot camera that they used and the stuff that didn't exist. So for this film, I guess it's a matter of building the replicas and building all the models and things and then shooting it rather than developing all the technology to actually do it in the first place.
Yeah, and so, I think Dennis Muren is the guy who you can take your hat off to. He really came to the fore in Empire.
He definitely
had a strong hand on all the effects.
The romance between Han and Leia.
Yeah, I mean, that's the backbone of this film. That's probably the most fun part of the whole film, is the back and forth between Leia and Han. And it's...
Well, this film is Han's film.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
Darth Vader's full character. I know you touched upon this before, Brose. He's brooding, scarred, murdering, and obviously we find out that he's a father as well. but again, first came up in this movie. Visually stunning lightsaber battles. The first one didn't have any visually stunning ones.
Yeah, there's the only one lightsaber battle in the first one.
And it's not very visually stunning.
It's two really old men.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. But this one, this is where it all started. And it's obviously been a staple of the series ever since. And the other thing as well, the Force ghosts are introduced in this film as
Do we not see Obi-Wan as a ghost? We just hear his voice in the first
when he's in the
X-Wing. Correct. Right, okay. Yep. And then we see the actual ghosts, which Lucas then dropped for the prequels. Apparently that doesn't happen at all.
No, it doesn't.
No, what's his name? Qui-Gon Jinn doesn't come back as a ghost, which was it was implied that he would, but didn't, so...
Yeah, so though the film was simply titled The Empire Strikes Back in its original promotional materials, the film still started with the title Star Wars on screen, which was followed by the opening crawl that gave the film subtitle as Episode 5, The Empire Strikes Back, causing some surprise among cinema goers at the time, as the original Star Wars film had not been given an episode number or subtitle for its first release in 1977. However, Episode 4, A New Hope, was added to its opening crawl from its 1981 release onwards. Do you remember when you saw Empire all those years ago? Do you remember having anything like that in regards to the whole episode thing?
No, I just think I was too young. We would have been, squealing just because the movie started.
It's another Star Wars movie.
The anticipation was huge. It was big. And I do remember in those days when movies came out, we were a good year behind. So a kid had flown to England, said the movie came back, and the first thing he said was, Darth Vader is Luke's
Oh, no. Really? Spoiled.
What? Massive spoiler
alert. What a Homer Simpson. That's insane.
Did you destroy that child?
We didn't believe him, and then we did.
Oh, no.
So quite angry.
There was that great phrase I remember from when I was in primary school about there was always one kid that it either got something or it'd seen something in the States before it came out here. And that was kind of like I got that in the States before it came out here. Yeah, I've already got that. Oh, have you got the new Star Wars Luke Skywalker in the Hoth gear? Yeah, I got it in the States before it came out. Yeah, I've already got it. That's the biggest wanky comment to make about something. And this guy went one step further and ruined it for everyone. Mm.
George Lucas's 1977 film Star Wars exceeded all expectations in terms of profit, its revolutionary effect on the film industry, and its unexpected resonance as a cultural phenomenon. Lucas hoped to become independent from the Hollywood film industry by financing The Empire Strikes Back himself with $33 million from loans and the previous film's earnings, going against the principles of many Hollywood producers never to invest one's own money. I guess when you're the guy who makes the most successful film of all time at the time, you can take the risk.
Yeah, absolutely.
And be confident as well.
In the commentary, again, the way Lucas's perspective when talking about Empire, which is quite interesting, is that when he made Empire, he knew it was going to be a hit. And I guess because, without social media and you know, you could really control the message a lot more in terms of marketing the film. But because Star Wars was a hit, or A New Hope was a hit, he knew, at least in his mind and his confidence, that Empire was going to be a hit. So he didn't worry when he made this film about appeasing people or second-guessing himself. He just made the film he wanted to make, knowing it would at least cover his costs and then go on to be...
I think it's interesting, though. He handed it over. He handed the reins over to someone who was really not that well-known and not known for anything since, really.
Yeah, if you look at his Irvin Kershner's career, he hasn't done much at all.
Yeah.
A lot of kind of factory Hollywood kind of films and stuff, like nothing particularly advanced, yeah.
Yeah, Lucas offered the role of director to Irvin Kershner.
Thank God he did, by the way.
I agree. One of his former professors at the USC School of Cinematic Arts. Kershner was known for smaller scale character-driven films, but had more recently directed the intense true-life drama Raid on Entebbe and the 1978 thriller Eyes of Laura Mars. Kershner initially turned Lucas down, citing his belief that a sequel would never meet the quality or originality of Star Wars. He called his agent, who immediately demanded that he take the job. Surprise, surprise. Lucas also hired Lee Brackett and later Lawrence Kasdan to write the screenplay based on his original story. Brackett completed her draft in February 1978 before, unfortunately, dying of cancer. Lucas wrote the second draft before hiring Kasdan, who had impressed him with his draft for Raiders of the Lost Ark.
Yeah, of course.
Following a difficult production, The Empire Strikes Back received mixed reviews from critics initially, which I actually found really surprising. Some mixed reviews when it came out.
No, I don't find it that. I don't at all. It's a populist film, remember, and Star Wars was a massive hit, and it was denigrated by critics. So,
and it didn't have the crowd-pleasing ending either, which I think would have been a big shock.
I think just the nature of this type of film, the big blockbuster, and the blockbuster was in its infancy still at this point. Jaws being the first blockbuster, we've mentioned that before, and then Star Wars using that, I guess, that development in film release. But it doesn't surprise me critics were against it. It's populist stuff. It makes sense.
It's definitely grown in esteem, though, becoming one of the most critically acclaimed chapters in the Star Wars saga, and it's now considered one of the greatest films ever made. It became the highest grossing film of 1980, and to date has earned more than $538 million worldwide from its original run and several re-releases, of course. When adjusted for inflation, it's the 12th highest grossing film in North America.
Wow.
So it's very, very much up there. So what are some of your initial thoughts on this one, guys? Like, can you remember, obviously, Mark, you've told us about the first time that you saw it, but can you guys, yourself, Andrew, or Brose, remember the first time you saw it? And what are your general feelings and opinions on what is arguably one of the most popular films in the franchise?
Everything that I love about Star Wars, this film encapsulates the magic of the films, and it's obviously the peak of the series, in my opinion. And it's just great storytelling. I think it's just... You know, you see so many crappy blockbusters these days, and you just look back at this film and just think, back then they were actually still telling stories. They're using the effects to heighten the storyline and, you know, build character, which is very rare now. So, yeah, it's just a beautifully told film about people. And when you see it, the more and more you see it, you realize it is the success of it is that you're totally emotionally engaged with these characters, and you really feel for them when, you know, the things aren't going well for them in this film. And what strikes me about the film is that it's so dark, you know, that they have these little victories and then it gets taken away from them. And the Empire's always got the upper hand. And it's a very courageous thing to do for a mainstream film, is to make something so unrelentingly dark like that.
Nah, definitely couldn't agree more. And what about yourself, Brose?
Yeah, I guess, I mean, for me, when I was a kid, Jedi was the film. But when Jedi came out, I was maybe five or six, I think. And I got caught up in all that. For me, even at this age, I was a huge Jim Henson fan, a big Muppets fan. So just Yoda in this film for me was, as a kid, that was it. I mean, this was the ultimate for me. And this is probably, without doubt, the best representation of Yoda in all of the films to
date.
I don't think Yoda is funnier or as intelligent or as wise as he is in this film in any other film. So for that, I mean... Alone, that I loved it for that reason. And then as I got older, obviously, the same kind of thing. You know, you realize the darkness of the ending and the tone all the way through. And the lightness between Han and Leia. Yeah, it's great. It's a great film.
And what about yourself, Mark, as well? Where does this sit for you?
For fun, I like episode 4. But to sink your teeth into a storyline for every character, I think every character has something developed for them. And not only that, you've all those things you hear about in episode 4, the Empire, Darth Vader. You'll learn about, it's a movie that you learn about everything that is Star Wars. And Jedi, I actually think Jedi is darker than, Ewoks aside, Jedi is darker than Empire. I think Empire is more lighthearted. But by the time you get to Jedi, my feelings are kind of like, eh, ran out of steam. These guys are going to hurt each other. And there you go.
Which happens a lot with the third film in the franchise as well.
It did fall off. But, I mean, Empire really keeps you thoroughly... No, you're stuck to your chair the whole time. I think it's great storytelling. I think the best thing that Lucas did was hand the reins over, do the post-production, do all that stuff, do what he does best. Because I think, and when you look back now at the prequels, you think, well, everybody's very wooden. The character thing, where is it? You know, what's going on?
One of the things Kirshner talks about in the commentary, he mentions at one point, which is a really nice moment, he talks about C-3PO and R2-D2, and he talked about how he didn't want them just to be sidelined and pushed aside in this film, and he wanted to make sure they had their own character, that they had their own feelings, they had their own emotions, even though they were droids. But the important thing about that statement is that basically what he was using that is to illustrate that even the characters right at the bottom of the pile in this film, in terms of what the script he was given, he wanted to build strong characters from the bottom all the way up. And and he does. And that, I think that's what gives this film so much strength, is that, I mean, even in Jedi, some of the Ewok characters are not even developed. They don't even exist. Whereas every character in this that is given screen time is given a life. It's given a real backstory and
you can almost really like, well developed. Obviously the Lawrence Kasdan, his presence in this film, he gives it this kind of big chill in space kind of vibe, you know, where it's just this group of friends who are in this really dark, you know, plight, and they've got to try and work it out together and survive. And it's just fascinating watching the dynamics between, you know, Han and Leia, and even C-3PO kind of, you know, it frustrates them and in the midst of stress and things like that. Just how do they get themselves out of these binds? It's great writing.
Yeah, there's an immediate tone shift between episodes 4 and 5 that's reflected in the characters of Luke, Han, Leia and Vader. Everything suddenly becomes a lot more serious. And the idea of the rebels being on the run in the midst of a bitter and deadly civil war is never better exemplified than it is here. It's a war film and it's a chase film. It's a spiritual journey to the light and dark sides of Luke's psyche. And it surpasses and expands upon A New Hope in practically every possible way. One of the key factors at work here, which was entirely absent from the prequels, is that the characters care about each other.
Yeah.
They worry about each other. Their own lives become less important, and it sets up a bond of friendship that holds the entire saga together, I feel. In the prequels, Anakin represents Obi-Wan. Padme fears, resents, and is annoyed by Anakin. And Obi-Wan fears, resents, and is annoyed by Anakin. There's no bond. We don't feel it. The first thing in Empire, Han worries about Luke. Then Leia, Chewie and the droids worry about Luke and Han. Then when they get back together and once again part ways, they constantly keep one another in mind.
Caring more about someone than yourself is it's kind of Han Solo's strength.
Yep.
In that he obviously cares for Leia and protects Leia. But also when he's about to go into the Carbonite, he expresses that, you know, she's got to look after Chewbacca. So he's obviously caring about all the people that are around him. Whereas for Luke Skywalker, caring about other people is kind of his weakness when it comes to being a Jedi, because he won't continue his training and look at the bigger picture. He wants to go off and save 3 people that Yoda sees as being kind of insignificant. So even within the script, even that very idea that caring for other people more than yourself is a key theme, it's used quite sophisticatedly in the script, which is amazing. Yeah.
Now, The Empire Strikes Back is a Lucasfilm release, so probably one of the most successful independent films of all time.
Well, George Lucas is the most successful independent film producer of all time, uncategorically.
Yep.
There's no one even comes close.
It was released on the 20th of June, 1980 in the US and the 7th of August, 1980 in Australia. And the special edition re-released just quickly, bro, the 21st of February, 1997 in the US and the 10th of April, 1997 in Australia. It was shot primarily at Elstree and Lee International Studios in England and the UK. And the exterior sequences were shot in Oregon in the US as well. And some scenes were also shot near Finse in Norway.
Yeah, that's the glacier, all the hot stuff.
The stuff at the beginning of the movie,
yep,
right?
Yep, the first 20 minutes or so.
Like the filming of Star Wars, where the production in Tunisia coincided with the area's first major rainstorm in 50 years, the weather was against the film crew again. While filming in Norway, they encountered the worst winter storm in 50 years. Temperatures dropped to minus 29 degrees Celsius.
Wow.
And 18 feet of snow fell. On one occasion, the crew were unable to exit the hotel. They achieved the shot involving Luke's exit on the Wampa Cave by opening the hotel's doors and filming Mark Hamill running out into the snow while the crew remained warm inside. Get out there, Mark, and do the hard work for us. We'll stay here where it's warm.
In the commentary, it's great. I don't know if Lucas or Kirshner brings it up, but they talk about the advice Lucas gave Kirshner was that everything will go wrong. And when you get there, nothing will work. And Kirshner goes, I'm glad I got that advice, because the rubber suits for for the Tauntauns and stuff, they froze up, and the different bodily fluids supposed to come out, they wouldn't come out, the mechanisms wouldn't work, the R2 units wouldn't work, like nothing worked the way it was supposed to work. But he was forewarned, so they got to work around it. Yeah.
And here we go as well, Mark. The budget was an estimated $18 million, $7 million more than the original.
That's a lot of money back in that time. You've got to put your old hat on. That's a lot of money.
Absolutely.
I mean, what movies would have been made for under probably under two?
Oh, yeah, exactly.
Big movies?
Yeah, and it grossed $538.4 million worldwide.
Is that including, that's not including the re-release?
I think it's in total.
Right, yep.
Right? Which is massive, and you'd take that any day of the week for any movie for obvious reasons, but it's nearly $240 million less than the original.
Wow.
Yep.
Okay.
So we did talk about him a little bit, but the director of this one is Irvin Kershner. So right off the bat, was this a good decision?
Yeah.
Lucas is not directing this one.
Yeah. Of course. I think time has revealed that it was a good decision. It's the one movie that really stands out. It's probably everybody says it's their favourite. There has to be a reason for that.
I think this is a big reason.
Yeah, I think Lucas probably did the right thing. He was sitting in an edit suite or, you know, somewhere at Hollywood somewhere, receiving the dailies from Kershner, who just had to churn it out. I think he could craft the movie better. He was probably better back in the post-production, crafting it, you know, editing it and doing all that sort of stuff. I think one of the frustrations you probably had was when you're out shooting something, you shoot, quick, let's get it done. We've got to get this, got to say that, then we've got to be here, got to do that. And it's being sort of edited somewhere else, and you've got less involvement. I think he wanted more involvement, and not directing it probably gave him that.
He's definitely a guy that really enjoys the writing process and has a lot of fun, and you know, being on his own and producing the story in this instance, and then the scripts were then developed from there. But then he would have been editing and working with the screenwriter, so he gets to oversee things there and then let someone else go and make it with his story and someone else's script and then sit back and oversee everything. I think he's got a better control of a bigger picture in that situation, and I think he nailed it in this instance. Yeah.
What do you think as well, Andrew?
I think no doubt the proof is in the performances. Like, they just, the performances have got so much more depth and, you know, a little kind of texture to them that you didn't have in the first film. And I think that's a sign of good direction in the way he's blocked the scenes and gets just really strong kind of camaraderie between everyone. And, you know, from reading stories about how he directs as well, like, he really took the time to work with the actors and rehearse, and, you know, he was much more of a people person, I think, to his actors than maybe Lucas was.
Yeah, I think also what Kershner got to do was get a hold of this script, which I don't think was a great script when he got it. I don't think there was a great film in his hands when he looked at that script, but he did unpack it and then put it back together again, work out how to make each film work, work how to consistently get the characters across each scene that they appear in to build a bigger story and more development into the characters. So Kershner, as an actor's director, really got to work out how to make the script sing from what could have been a very flat film if not someone that was looking at it from that perspective.
Now, nobody knows who he is, so just quickly, guys. Irvin Kershner was an American film director and occasional actor, best known for directing quirky independent films early in his career. And then, of course, there was this one, The Empire Strikes Back, the James Bond film Never Say Never Again, that was Connery's return film, right?
Yeah, it was like a rehash of Thunderball, but a bad one.
Right.
And I liked it. If it's on TV, you'll watch it. I'm just going to say that. You cannot stop but watch it.
Yeah. And also,
Kim Bassinger.
RoboCop 2, he directed.
I didn't even know there was a RoboCop 2.
Oh, really?
What, you thought they went straight to 3? You're telling me you didn't know there was a RoboCop 3?
I didn't.
Kershner was born in Philadelphia in 1923. He began his film career at the University of Southern California School of Cinematic Arts, teaching photography and taking cinema courses. Kershner then accepted a job as still photographer on a State Department film project in Iran under the Point 4 program, which ultimately led to an assignment as a director and cinematographer of documentaries in Iran, Greece, and Turkey with the United States Information Service. He then moved on to feature films, but of course, he is regarded as a surprising choice to this day, and according to Kershner himself, he once asked producer George Lucas, of all the younger guys around, all the hot shots, why me? Lucas replied, well, because you know everything a Hollywood director is supposed to know, but you're not Hollywood. What a great story.
It's a good story. Wow. You know, it's surprising that Spielberg didn't end up doing it. That's a surprise.
Yeah, that is as unusual. I mean, Spielberg would have been pretty busy at the time himself with his own stuff, I suppose, but the...
He would have been prepping Raiders.
Yeah, he would have.
Well, that was a co-production too, wasn't
correct.
It?
Yeah, correct.
There was always talk that from Spielberg himself that Lucas said he could do one of the prequels and never did, so...
Helped.
Probably not.
Kirshner, who was an appealing candidate to Lucas because of his focus on character development, he was reluctant initially to direct the film.
Is the other factor, though, that just someone that Lucas could control? Like, is it
trust, control, not trust, part of the Hollywood system?
Like, is that part of it? It's like
it takes the romance out of it a little bit, but
You know, this is his baby. He wants to give it to a director that can, I guess, do the character stuff, like he said. But at the same time, he wants someone that can't turn around and say, "Well, I've just directed these films that are doing very well." You know, like, I don't know. Am I being too cynical?
No, I don't think you are, because you've got to sort of try and recall the public, the massive public hysteria. That was a reaction to Star Wars.
Yeah.
It was out of control.
It was as we discussed in Star Wars, in A New Hope, sci-fi films had never made money like that.
Yeah.
Sci-fi films had never been mainstream or been popular at all. They were always B-films. They were always a bit of a joke, a bit of a laugh, a bit cheap and a bit nasty. Yeah, he reinvented the sci-fi cinema and blockbuster cinema. So
he can't imagine the pressure that he was under in Episode 4. He had a nervous breakdown. I'm never going to do this again. And then ends up doing the sequel. The pressure must have been huge.
Oh, massive.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, Kirshner died on November 27th, 2010, at his home in Los Angeles after 3.5 years with lung cancer. And he'd been working on photography all the way up until his death. So, I guess simply being the director of Empire Strikes Back, you really leave quite a lasting legacy, don't you?
Yeah, completely.
Absolutely. That and...
Never seen it again.
Yeah. Now, we touched upon them a little bit, but the writers, Brose, Lee Brackett, who gets a screenplay credit, she delivered the draft and then passed away 2 years before the film actually came out.
Wow.
Lawrence Kasdan, screenplay credit, and George Lucas for the story. The writers captured everything that was interesting about Lucas's universe and then made it for grown-ups as well. That's how I look at Empire Strikes Back in comparison to the first one. It's lean, snappy, and clearly benefits from ad-libbing on the set as well. In short, it's how a Star Wars film should be scripted, at least in my opinion.
So just interesting. Sorry, I just wanted to jump in real quick. Lee Brackett, who did the first draft, had written a lot of Westerns before this. So El Dorado was one of hers, Rio Bravo, The Long Goodbye, Suspicion... The Big Sleep. There's some impressive films there in her back pocket. So Star Wars works well as a Western. Like, it works well in the... Han Solo works as the man with no name kind of character. Yeah. Like, all the fundamental story elements of a Western.
There is a line, "I'll see you in hell." And he, like, snaps on the torch. That's not a Western. Classic.
It was left in from her scripts. That's right. Yeah.
Then the Tauntaun broke down. It's just like, oh.
Now, although the credits list Brackett and Lawrence Kasdan as having written the script, the pair of them did not collaborate on the screenplay at all. George Lucas came up with an outline for the movie and assigned Brackett to write it. Brackett completed a first draft in February 1978 and then sadly passed away in March 1978, so 1 month later after she handed it in. Unfortunately, the draft she had written did not satisfy Lucas, who then wrote a draft himself, for which he's uncredited, before hiring Kasdan, who had just finished writing an unseen draft of Raiders of the Lost Ark. Although the major story points that take place are of Lucas's conception, Kasdan streamlined the story, tightened up the dialogue, and deepened the character relationships. In other words, did all the hard work.
Yeah.
Kasdan later went on to write the sequel Return of the Jedi with Lucas in much the same fashion. Brackett is credited because she turned in the screenplay, even though none of her work made it on screen. At all, but she still gets the credit. Lucas has commented, though, that although she was a very gifted writer, Brackett was the wrong choice for a Star Wars movie, and he stated, "I didn't like the first script, but I gave Lee credit because I liked her a lot. She was sick at the time she wrote it, and she really tried her best."
And again, without being too cynical, her name on the screenplay does lend this film some credibility.
Yeah.
She's a big Hollywood screenwriter, and at a time when critics are being cynical and everyone else is, you know, in terms of the establishment, are turning their nose down at this film.
And George Lucas can do whatever the hell he wants, and if he wants to tribute this lady, she's sick, then so be it.
Yeah, I think it's great.
With no writer available, Lucas had to write the next draft himself. It was this draft in which Lucas first made use of the episode numbering for the films. Empire Strikes Back was listed as Episode 2. As Michael Kaminsky argues in The Secret History of Star Wars, disappointment with the first draft probably made Lucas consider different directions in which to take the story. He made use of a new plot twist. Darth Vader claims to be Luke's father. According to Lucas, he found this draft enjoyable to write as opposed to the year-long struggles writing the first film, and quickly wrote two more drafts, both in April 1978. He also took the script to a darker extreme by having Han Solo imprisoned in carbonite and left in limbo. The new story point of Darth Vader being Luke's father has drastic effects on the series. Michael Kaminsky argues in his book that it is unlikely that the plot point had ever seriously been considered or even conceived before 1978, and that the first film was clearly operating under an alternate storyline where Vader was separate from Luke's father. There is not a single reference to this plot point before 1978.
Well, he is a different character, and we know that as well. One of the things that's talked about is that when they filmed the stuff with Vader saying he was his father, none of that dialogue was used either. That was all added in by James Earl Jones, obviously, in post. But there was different dialogue being delivered on set. And then Mark Hamill's responding, knowing that Vader's his father, responding as if that's the dialogue he's hearing, but actually replying to the false dialogue. So maybe Lucas was teeter-tottering all the way up until editing, even, about on what to do with that. But it's a huge revelation.
It's a massive revelation, I mean, because people would just watch the first film now, taking into account all the storyline plot points that have been developed in the second and third films. And they just, because it's a perfect little trilogy, they just like all merge it all together. The cinematographer, Andrew, of this one is, I think it's pronounced Peter Suszczycki.
Suszczycki, I think.
Is that right?
Yeah, it's Polish.
Yep. So what do you think of his work in this film, Andrew?
I think he is absolutely integral to this film. It's the most stunning Star Wars film, I think, out of all of them.
Your favourite in regards to the visual style?
Absolutely. I just think he contributes such a massive amount in terms of atmosphere and, you know, bold colours and, you know, the lighting on the Yoda location, the Dagobah, you know, just that is a stunning, stunning piece of work. And you just feel like, you know, you're there. You feel like the moisture's in the air, and it's a swamp.
It's so atmospheric.
You know? So beautifully done, and yeah, so many great set pieces that he created. You know, there's obviously the iconic carbon freezing room where there's two scenes where Han goes down, and when there's the fight with Luke and Darth later on, and it's just the, you know, the contrast of the blue and the red, and, you know, good versus evil, and the silhouettes. It's just, it's iconic stuff. I mean, it's, you know, imagery that people remember as Star Wars. So I think, yeah, he has to be celebrated for his work, really. It's stunning.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's more adventurous than I think what Lucas found when he went to, was it Pinewood? They did a lot of the first one.
Yes.
It was a really old school crew. And I think he had a lot of battles with the cinematographer there. Like, he'd say, I want it done this way. He'd go, no, we're doing it this traditional, and, you know, the kind of BBC attitude. And I think that all that, those shackles were dropped from that movie on once it was so successful. And it shows. I think, yeah, there's a lot more movement, a lot more fun.
Yeah. The thing is that I think Lucas originally wanted Suszczycki to be the DOP on the first film. And I don't think that somehow that was vetoed. But, yeah, got him for the second one, obviously. So he obviously had the sights on him for a long time. And, yeah, makes it his own.
Yeah, I think Kirshner collaborated quite a lot with him as well. I think it was a good teaming up of the two of them. And the kind of character elements Kirshner wanted to introduce, and then the moods he wanted to create in different scenes, those ideas that Kirshner was bringing, Suszczycki knew how to express visually really well. I think the two of them played off each other perfectly. Yeah,
And he's got a great back catalogue too. Like, he, you know, classic film that we've discussed during the James Horner episode, Krull, which is a little 80s gem. That's a great looking film as well. Like, you know, he brings a lot of his talents from this film into that. And he's Cronenberg's go-to guy these days. Like, he's done a hell of a lot of Cronenberg's films, and they're beautiful looking films, like Crash and Naked Lunch, Dead Ringers, I think he did, and you know, right up to the current one, Map of Stars. Mm-hmm. So he's, yeah, very, very talented craftsman. And yeah, just what can you say? Just, yeah, it's a beautiful looking film.
He did Mars Attacks as well.
Yeah,
which is very stylistic. That's a great.
Yeah, it looks, that looks
beautifully
fantastic.
Shot film. Yeah,
bro, let's talk about the iconic cast.
The iconic cast.
I know it's,
you say it trepidatiously now because you've been saying iconic cast for every film we've ever looked at.
Just about.
You know, they are iconic in this instance.
We are talking about Empire Strikes Back.
They passed the silhouette rule.
That's right. Mark Hamill plays Luke Skywalker, returning, a young commander of the Rebel Alliance's Rogue Squadron and Jedi in training, who, after a vision of his old mentor, Ben Kenobi, sets out to find Jedi Master Yoda on the Dagobah. Looking now like a battle-ravaged warrior, he seems now to be worlds away from the somewhat squeaky farm boy of A New Hope.
Yeah, well, Mark Hamill...
This is where Luke Skywalker...
Hamill had a car accident between the two films. And so this Luke Skywalker in this film is the battle-damaged Mark Hamill post-car accident, which then Lucas... things like it's the Wampa that kidnaps him. So the effects of the Wampa are kind of to explain partly why his face is just so different. Mm. He definitely looks a lot older, a lot more than only a couple of years older than he was.
So what's the time gap supposed to be in this Star Wars universe? But I can't remember.
You mean where does this
place how many years?
Narratively speaking.
Yeah. I don't know. Does the movie give you anything?
I don't think so.
I don't think it gives you anything in regards to time.
Because
I don't think
Empire and Jedi pick up, that's almost immediately follows on.
You sense maybe a couple of years or something. It feels like they've been, you know, kind of hiding out at Hoth for quite a while, but it's never explained.
Hmm. Yeah, Mark Hamill's a lot more comfortable this time around. He's grown into like Luke Skywalker more.
Yeah, and he's obviously taken some acting classes at some point as well. He's toned it right down. He's a lot more subtle. He's acting in this film rather than just acting like a child.
Do you like the way that they take Skywalker in this one as well?
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously a lot darker and he's a lot more mature and they've matured him very quickly, and I think that helps establish the tone of this film as well. But
he's actually doesn't have a lot in the film, is he?
He hasn't got heaps to do, and he's still a little bit whiny on Dagobah. A little bit whiny. You still want to punch him around the face a little bit occasionally.
He spends a lot of this film by himself as well. But when I say by himself, yes, he's with Yoda, but Mark Hamill was definitely by himself.
But he's always being told things. He's always listening. He's the student, and it's a very light role for considering he's the main hero from the first film. It's quite interesting.
Yeah, definitely.
It is. Harrison Ford returns as Han Solo, and let's be honest, this is Han Solo's movie.
Yeah, Harrison Ford is Han Solo in this film. There's no separation. He's just so well in character. He's perfect. It's great.
A mercenary smuggler who initially aids the rebellion in exchange for money but has since accepted a ranking position within the Rebel Alliance. Although he intends to leave the rebels on his ship, the Millennium Falcon, to go and pay off a debt to a gangster, Jabba the Hutt, he is trapped by Hoth by the Imperial blockade. So sort of having Han Solo sort of frozen in carbonite was at least in part due to the fact that they were not sure whether or not Harrison Ford will return for a third film. So,
oh, really?
Yeah. Wow. So when the original Star Wars Episode IV, New Hope, was made, Carrie Fisher and Mark Hamill were signed for a three-picture deal, but Harrison Ford refused this. Ford even requested George Lucas to kill off Solo since the character had played its part already. But Lucas refused, saying that he still had a heroic part for Han Solo to play in Star Wars Episode VI, Return of the Jedi.
You could almost argue he's right, because, I mean, Return of the Jedi, Han Solo is...
watered down.
He's pretty wooden as well.
Yeah. So, yeah, as we said, this is Han's film. So what do we think of Harrison Ford in this one?
He's outstanding. You learn a lot more about him. That he's I think we discussed it before. He's lovable, friendly, he's caring, but he's probably the real hero behind the scenes. Like, it's a two-pronged thing. You got Luke on one side. When Luke's not there, Han picks it up. He's a protector. And they cover each other's back. And you learn more about the characters that way. He goes out to get him when he's in danger on Hoth. There's a debt to be paid.
There's a brother relationship.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
And Han Solo uses a lightsaber in this film, which is awesome. I always thought as a kid he would be like, you know, a Jedi as well. And I was just like, it's probably a bit much.
And he shoots. He fires a shot at Darth Vader, and what a great scene at the dinner table.
That's great. It's fantastic.
Yeah, there's a lot of cool moments.
Yeah, one of my favourite scenes, definitely. Carrie Fisher plays Princess Leia, a young, high-ranking official in the Rebel Alliance's chain of command. A little anecdote here before we just get into her character. She stood Carrie Fisher actually stood on a box for many of her scenes with Harrison Ford in order to make up the height difference to have her appear in the same frame with him. Carrie Fisher, who's about 5'1", is about a foot shorter than Harrison Ford, who's about 6'1". So it would look quite awkward then. Would have been quite tough for the cinematographer there as well.
A lot of low angles.
Yes, definitely. So anyway, so what do you think of Fisher in this one?
Fisher said that there's a couple of scenes where she has big kind of military dialogue kind of, you know, rousing the troops kind of scenes and things, and she conceded she had no idea what she was talking about. And given that she wasn't really up on what the content of her dialogue was supposed to be, she absolutely nails it. She's ferocious. She's a great leader, and then all the stuff, she's so angry with Han in the scenes later on. She's brilliant. She's so great in this film, and she looks stunning too. So.
Yeah, so brave, but she's afraid of a little Minoc.
I mean, again, how old was she in this one? Was she 21, 22?
22.
I mean, you forget that. Like, you know, she still kind of comes across as a woman in this film, but she's just very...
I'm still getting used to the fact that she's only 19 in the first one.
I know. Yeah. Like, it's staggering.
Billy Dee Williams plays Lando
Calrissian.
Calrissian, thank you.
The only black man in the galaxy that's not wearing an outfit.
Yeah. Make him look so black. He's like the Baron Administrator of Bespin's Cloud City and a longtime friend of Han. And you can really feel the camaraderie between those two. Those two have been friends for a really long time.
Yeah, they play poker together.
Yeah. Yeah. So what do you think of good old Billy Dee Williams here, guys?
What's that to say? Yeah.
No, I like Lando. I think he plays the role well. We first meet him. He's very unlikable. We don't trust him.
Yeah.
But he comes good. What happened with the whole Millennium Falcon thing? That's a bit of a strange part of the relationship. Like, we learned it was actually his ship, and he sort of just takes charge of it, and I think he's still driving it in Jedi.
Yeah,
I find that bit a bit strange.
Lando flies the Millennium Falcon away at the end of this film.
Yeah, right.
And they kind of wave goodbye to him as he flies off somewhere.
Yeah, it's a bit weird.
And he's kind of... I got thrown because he's kind of smiling when they're going off to get him at the end. It's kind of like, it's kind of not a smiley time, is it, Lando? Shit's gone down and he's just kind of like, yeah, let's go get him, guys.
Maybe that's why Han has constant problems with the Millennium Falcon, because he doesn't actually know how to fix it. He needs Lando's special touch to come in and solve them. Like, they never get that bloody thing right. It's always being repaired. Yeah. Him and Chewie are always yelling at each other. Lando knows how to fix the bloody thing. Get it up on blocks. Let's have a look at it.
Anthony Daniels returns, Brose, as C-3PO, Leia's golden protocol droid. We spoke a bit about Anthony Daniels on the first Star Wars episode, and really, it's just a continuation of that, really, isn't it?
I think he's the most annoying part of the film for me.
Okay.
And I know he's supposed to be, but it's just like, every time I watch it, he does... He's grating, and I think that's the only kind of thing I struggle with this film is just the, I guess he's a little bit kind of one note, and it's just always bickering and
whining. It is interesting because they separate C-3PO and R2 in this, obviously for the first time, because in the first film they're together. In the first film, R2 is so driven and so passionate and so determined, and C-3PO obviously is being cynical, but also then kind of translating R2 for everyone else they come across. So in this film, C-3PO doesn't have that role to play anymore, and Kirshner's trying his hardest to make him relevant and keep him in there, and he's kind of, he's still kind of the doubter and kind of the wimp, I guess, that he's, but he can be a bit grating,
But then he gets blasted, and then you go, no!
Yeah, exactly.
You're mortified.
Yeah. But at least, and I guess it comes back to that same idea, at least you can see that C-3PO, he's not doing it because he's, I guess, just a coward. He also cares for people and doesn't want to see people go into danger and take too big a risk, I suppose, yeah.
And, of course, that means Kenny Baker's back playing R2-D2.
Well, in the whichever scenes he happens to be in, the tin bucket, and whichever one seemed to be a remote control. But, he's still there.
Is he still... I remember when we did A New Hope, Brose, you said he was one of your favourite characters of the Star Wars universe.
Yeah, R2 and Yoda are my two favourite characters, without a doubt. I did posit the theory that R2 has the Force, which is evident in the first film. There's no evidence of it in Empire at all. But he is pretty much sidelined. And the theory that I'm running with at the moment is that the reason he doesn't show any evidence of the Force on Dagobah is that he's aware of who Yoda is and doesn't want Yoda to be aware that he has the Force.
He'll justify anything.
He's starstruck, is that what you're saying?
But just wait. No, not starstruck. It's that a robot shouldn't have the Force. He shouldn't be filled with midichlorians, so he's keeping it a secret.
You've really thought about this.
I have thought about it. But let me just say, zero evidence that R2 has the Force in this film, but wait for Jedi. There'll be some evidence in that film, no question. No question.
Peter Mayhew plays Chewbacca again, Han's Wookiee co-pilot and close friend. I have to say, the highlight for me with Chewie in this film is he probably has one of the most emotionally powerful moments in the film, which is actually towards the end, when his reaction to Han being put into the...
Carbonite.
The Carbonite.
But his reaction to C-3PO as well.
Yeah.
And then again with, he's quite emotional in this.
He doesn't talk, obviously, but you feel like how in distress he is just through, his sounds that he makes as well.
Yeah, it's remarkable. I think the costume itself has had a little bit of work between the two films.
What are the differences you noticed?
It just looks a little bit neater and he looks a little bit...
His hair's awesome in this one.
His hair looks spectacular in this, Either that or he's got a contract with Vidal Sassoon or something. But
he looks like a member of Grateful Dead in this one.
The puppet itself, I think, has had a little bit of work. Just a little bit neater, a little bit it's been rebuilt and just a little bit better construction. But the performances are amazing. And it's a combination, obviously, Peter Mayhew's inside, and then who's the audio...
Ben Bird.
Sound designer, doing all the sound design for Chewbacca, which, I mean, we've talked about it in the first New Hope podcast, but the work he does for R2 and Chewbacca especially is just... remarkable to create those incredible performances.
Yeah. And he's returning as well in episode 7.
Oh, really?
Is that right? Oh, yeah.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah. Peter Mayhew.
Yes. Yes, definitely. David Prowse-James L. Jones plays Darth Vader. Now, yeah, this is the key thing for this whole movie for me is what they do with the character. So, obviously, Vader is a Sith and loyal agent of Emperor Palpatine who is obsessed with finding Luke who destroyed the Death Star. His search brings him to Hoth where he orders a blockade of the ice planet. Now, in A New Hope, he was almost a prototype, displaying most of the characteristics he would later be famous for in well-lit rooms, conversing tersely with bureaucrats. In Return of the Jedi, he's Anakin Skywalker, trapped in the suit, wrestling with his conflicted conscience and trying to work out what to do with the shred of soul he recently rediscovered. In Empire, he is Darth Vader. A mechanical and unnerving presence standing in the shadows, striking mortal terror into the hearts of his enemies and allies alike. He stalks the corridors and bridge, dealing out merciless punishment to those who disappoint and single-mindedly pursuing our heroes across the galaxy. In Cloud City, he appears as the specter of death at the one moment we'd all breathe a sigh of relief during the period of desperately sought safety for Han, Leia, Chewie, and C-3PO. He is there to capture, torture, and imprison, using Han's agony in a twisted message to Luke, assume that his heartfelt attachment to his friends will bring him into his clutches. And then, during the duel, he controls the flow of combat entirely, fighting one-handed and mocking young Skywalker, prodding at a rage he hopes is down there. He humiliates and hounds Luke up to the point where his son actually scores a lucky hit, which causes Vader to lash out and dismember the boy. His aim is to break Luke down until there is nothing left but burning desire to live at any cost. The same desire that kept Anakin alive just long enough to be put into the Vader suit. His short-sightedness leads him to believe that Luke would join him against the Emperor through arrogance and self-preservation. This, in my opinion, is what we all think of when we think of Darth Vader, is the way he's presented right here in Empire.
Did you write that? Who wrote that?
That's
wrote
heavy.
That. Jesus. Wow. That's amazing.
It's so true.
This,
yeah. It's very cool.
That small scene in this film, really, it's only, you know, 10 minutes or 8 minutes of screen time. That sets up the entire Star Wars saga, as far as I'm concerned.
Yep.
The first three films are about that relationship. Mm-hmm. They're about Vader. They're about Luke Skywalker. Everything else is kind of window dressing. Han Solo is like a sideshow. That's the essence of, you know, Luke becoming a Jedi, Darth Vader being the Sith Lord, and being father and son. That's the whole deal. And it's just nailed. It's perfect.
You agree, Mark? Vader in this one?
Yeah, I think we really wanted to see, you know, Luke battle Darth Vader.
Yeah.
That's what we really wanted to see, and Empire gave us... I love that the scene. I don't know how long it is. It's very, very atmospheric. There's not much soundtrack in it. There's a lot of sound effects, drone.
Well, there's no kind of music. There's no music at all.
Eerie.
The decision was made to only have the sound effects from the
lightsabers. Which is really interesting in a Star Wars movie because the score is like another character.
Yeah.
True.
And plays through a lot of it. And to actually get rid of it for such an integral battle is a really, really interesting decision.
So the decision was that the lightsabers already have a musical quality with the back and forth and the clashing and the percussive feel. So, yeah, there was no music to be used in that sequence. I'm not sure whose decision that was, but it's... I've forgotten his name again.
Ben Burt.
Ben Burt is the one that mentions it on the commentary, yeah.
And James L. Jones has nailed Vader in this one as well. The difference between his voice performance in the first one compared to this one is like, he's heads and shoulders above.
I mean, Vader doesn't have much to do in the first film, which we've discussed plenty of times. And you can see why James L. Jones might have been a bit lost and a bit confused. But in this film, it's all there. And I don't know who directed James L. Jones. I assume Lucas would have. I don't know if Kirshner did. But yeah, he's just magnificent in this. It's all the imposing
Vader. He becomes the ultimate arsehole boss, doesn't he, in this? He's just like, he's got full power over everyone. And just like, can you imagine just like waking up in the morning and having to fucking go to work for Darth Vader? he's the worst. You have no idea.
If you've seen Into the Robot Chicken, they've nailed it.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
I've
got to
check that out. If you haven't seen that, you've got to check
that
out.
And there's the Eddie Izzard routine too, which is fantastic.
Yeah, funny. Yeah. I think Darth Vader's suit is so much better looking in this movie.
It is, yeah.
There must have been a decision at some point. Because the first one, you would go back and watch it, it looks like heavy steel. It looks clunky. But he's swift, he's darker, he's sleeker, it's shinier, he looks awesome.
The eyes as well, like they're more defined and just gives it a lot more character, doesn't it?
Yeah.
How much atmosphere does the sound effect of his breathing add to any scene that he's in as well? Yeah. Even when he's not talking.
Yeah.
Just staying there in his presence with that sound effect adds so much to the atmosphere.
That's so uniquely Star Wars. I can't think of another movie that can claim that.
Oh, no.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, the closest you'd get is probably in Blue Velvet with the... it's kind of similar, isn't it? Yeah. Don't you look at me! that's as close as it gets.
Now, he is played by an amazing puppet, but Frank Oz does the voice of one of the most famous characters from Star Wars, Yoda, who makes his first appearance here in Empire Strikes Back. The self-exiled Jedi Grand Master who lives on Dagobah. Now, George Lucas was so impressed by Frank Oz's performance as Yoda that he spent thousands of dollars on an advertising campaign to try and get him an Oscar nomination for Best Supporting Actor.
Yeah, and the Academy wouldn't do it.
Lucas's campaign ultimately failed because it was felt that a puppeteer wasn't an actor. So right there, just like,
fuck you!
You I will fuck, yeah?
On that, Brose, Yoda's iconic manner of speech was has the parts of speech in object-subject-verb order. Very few languages on Earth use this, and most are based in the Amazon River Basin.
Oh, there you go.
There you go.
That's research. I just find him confusing.
Well done.
Do you?
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah? What do you guys think of the character of Yoda as it's represented here for the first time in Empire?
Yeah. I love Yoda. I love Yoda.
Well, you're a big Frank Oz guy.
Yeah, I love Frank Oz. I love Yoda. Yoda's incredibly well written. Lucas refers to him as being, apparently in old fables and traditional writings going back centuries, the hero would come upon a wizard or a magical being who is represented by a frog or some other unattractive creature that everyone else would ignore but the hero is sympathetic towards. And Yoda represents that in traditional folklore. And with that, then Lucas gets to create this character that's a little bit mischievous, a little bit more fun. You know, it's a little bit more, you know, waiting for Godot than popular sci-fi. And I just think Yoda's fantastic in this. And it's exactly kind of what Luke needs at this point, is someone just to play with him a little bit and, you know, not be super serious like Obi-Wan is and kind of being the big father figure kind of character, but just being kind of the wise but mischievous teacher.
It's a very Jim Henson kind of element that initially when you meet him and he's just that kind of, you know, zany little cute little
thing. He's going through all of Luke Skywalker's stuff. And
so funny
and
too.
A real like, smart ass and throwing stuff away.
That's fantastic, isn't it? Because there is a very clear turning point when he talks to Obi-Wan Kenobi, saying he's not ready. Yoda changes significantly from on that movie. He's very, and then he passes away, but he's very serious.
Yeah, Jim Henson was originally supposed to do Yoda, or at least this is one of the stories, and this is how it's written in the Jim Henson biography.
Wouldn't he just sound like Ernie from Sesame Street?
He would, yeah.
That'd be really
interesting. I mean, there's already a bit of Fozzie about Yoda as it is, but Jim Henson's workload, they'd just finished Dark Crystal and they were moving into the Labyrinth and his workload was just intense and he was still working on Sesame Street, obviously. And there was another Muppet movie in the mix there somewhere as well, Great Muppet Caper. So Jim Henson, there's no way he was going to be able to make it. But Frank Oz, who it is argued by various people, and I almost agree, Frank Oz, Jim Henson refers to as a better puppeteer, and he definitely brings a lot of personality. And I'm glad Frank Oz got the chance here to perform Yoda, because I think he brings a lot more to it, a lot more energy. And also that idea that, you know, Jim Henson's over the road producing Muppet bits and pieces, and Frank Oz gets to step out on his own and show what he can do, you know, out from under the shadow of Jim Henson's immense career. And it's spectacular. I think it's like a George Harrison post-Beatles moment for Frank Oz in a way.
But the close-ups of Yoda's face, he looks legit. He looks
exceptional.
Real.
Yeah.
The wider shots, and he kind of looks puppety. But when they go in close, there's such a great job on that puppet.
What about when CGI took over in the prequels?
No, don't buy it. Don't like it.
No, me either. No.
And the labor side, the lightsaber dancing, and that was just too much.
That, there's that classic image of Yoda, I think, that I always think of, you know, it's just that soft light that's just over him, and he's just, you know, with his little walking stick, and he's just watching Luke, and, you know, just the little ticks in his eyes, and just the little muscles, and the curl of his lip. I mean, that is,
you completely buy
artistry.
It. You do buy it.
It's worth mentioning with Yoda as well, in terms of the way the practical effect was done. It's a puppet. Frank Oz is the head puppeteer, but there are another seven or eight puppeteers as well operating. A lot of servos and mechanical pieces in the puppet to control all the different elements. So it's not a hand puppet as such. There's a lot of other stuff which Henson was one of the first places to adopt and develop a lot of that style of puppetry, which is why Lucas used him. Lucas knew it had to be a puppet because there was no other way to do it. Also knew that his technology probably wasn't going to be up to speed to look good enough in his film, the stuff that ILM or whoever else had been developing, and went straight to Henson and just said, you've got to do it, because he'd just done Dark Crystal using the same type of technology. Lucas in the commentary is a bit frustrating when Yoda pops up, because he just keeps... I mentioned this before we started recording. Lucas just mentions all the negatives about Yoda and all his frustrations and how much he hated having to use a puppet and how limited he was in terms of the blocking and how obvious it looks to him now that it's a guy under the stage and stuff. And it's just a little bit disappointing, because it's easier to focus on the negatives, I guess, but the positives of the way they use this puppet is exceptional, and the character that's brought to it is brilliant. And rightly so, to try and push him for an Academy Award nomination, because there's probably not a puppet performance better than this up until this point.
That's so charming.
It's just
the fact that you don't even when you're watching, you don't even think about the puppetry.
No, you don't.
You're
not at all.
Totally immersed in it.
Can you imagine underneath that stage, there's like, I don't know, what, 8-10 foot people underneath there working?
Yeah.
Would have been hideous. I wonder what their recollections are.
And the rehearsals, like to turn gears at the right point to get that reaction. Yeah. I mean, the amount of work that went into that. And as an audience member, you just totally believe
it. It'd be like performing a piece of music, all of them at one time, you know, doing the right things at the right time. It's exceptional.
Wasn't the set there? It was a very small set. Somebody's swimming pool or something?
it was a concrete-bottomed soundstage at Elstree, I believe.
I've been there.
That they built it in. But it was a very imposing set, because it took up pretty much the whole soundstage with no real space. So apparently when you went on set, it did feel very constricting and very claustrophobic. Trees growing on the set that grew in low light or zero light, and then the water was there, and a lot of the dry ice pumped in as well. So when you're in set, and dry ice, especially in 1980 or 1979 when they were making it, was... probably shouldn't have been breathing that in for too long. Not particularly healthy.
Now, if we're looking at Empire Strikes Back, there is one character played by Jeremy Bullock who we need to speak about. Boba Fett. What do you think it is, guys, firstly?
I've been a Boba man all my life.
Okay.
I hear Boba. Let's have like the
Boba seems correct to me, but I've always said Boba Fett.
Okay. Who is a Mandalorian bounty hunter who has gained infamy throughout the galaxy and worked in the past with Darth Vader, who now assigns him to hunt down the Millennium Falcon and transport Han to Jabba the Hutt. Now, what is it about the character of Boba Fett? Why is he so highly regarded as being absolutely awesome by Star Wars fans everywhere?
Something that I mentioned in the New Hope episode, and I think it's really relevant at this point. One of the things about Boba Fett was that they, if you remember I mentioned, they released the action figure of Boba Fett in the Star Wars line as a mail-away figure, and it was released 2 years before Empire Strikes Back came out. So if you're a fan, at the time, an 8-9-year-old or 12-13-year-old buying all the figures, Boba Fett kind of create your own myth around this character, because he doesn't exist in Star Wars and you know he's going to be in the next film. So I think in part that's a factor. The fact that Lucas teased the character before he even existed and kind of put the character out there before Empire was made, I think is a factor. But he doesn't do much in this film.
I was going to say, in this film, he stands around holding a gun.
Yeah, he doesn't do anything.
He doesn't kill anybody.
He's, and it's no shock, but he was my favourite character as a kid. I loved him. It's the costume.
He looks damn cool.
Is the primary reason?
Were you, Mark, aware of Boba Fett before you saw Empire? Do you remember? Or you
no, that I have no knowledge of that.
Yeah, okay.
I think the thing with him is he has that same sort of stoicness about him. Like, he's like an equal to Vader. They both have the mask. They both don't say a lot.
It is a very cool costume too, isn't it? That rocket on the back.
And, it's like the quiet, threatening resolve.
It's the mystery of, like, is he a robot? Is he a man? You know, what's under the mask?
Wasn't he the best-looking bounty hunter, too?
I mean, by far.
I don't want to go out with him.
But... What's that, Solo? Oh, blasters aren't fair? Okay, dig it. No blasters. Oh, didn't see that one coming, did you? Huh? So slow. Oh, you thought I was over there, but guess what? Over here. Oh, yeah. Little rope-a-dope, huh? Left, right. Oh, down goes Solo. Huh? What's that? Oh, you want a face-to-face? Well, let me just take this bad boy off my... Oh, he's even better looking without the helmet. Surprise ending. You want me to come closer? Oh, you don't want to fight anymore? Oh, your hands are up there almost like you're begging. Begging for a little piece of boba. Yeah, you like that, don't you? You like it because you're bad. Oh, yeah. You dirty little smuggler.
It came up better than the other guys.
He's standing there next to, what's his name, ID88?
Yeah,
that skeletal IG88.
Phallic-looking
skeletal
thing.
Robot thing. Yep. Looks like a reject from The Wizard of Oz.
There was Bosk.
And Bosk, yeah, he's not doing him any favours. He's going to list them all.
Yeah,
and he also gets away as well. He does. He avoids getting punked in this film.
And he tracks. He's all on. He's over Solo's plan when he's like attached to the Star Destroyer.
He's like one step ahead of him.
Yeah.
Almost.
So he's a cool dude.
Yeah.
It's interesting though because it really doesn't do much, and it's really just based on, like, I think, as you said, the costume and just his, like, his resolve. I think just like,
the minimalist kind of thing.
Wasn't the suit white to begin with? Am I correct? I think I've seen pictures of a white Boba Fett.
Okay, and then what was changed by the time we went?
Yeah, kind of stormtrooperish, and then they made it all green,
gray and red, and green and stuff.
And, when we look at Return of the Jedi, Brose, we'll see what they end up doing with him as well, which is one of the most bizarre decisions in the history of film.
I have heard a rumour, but I don't think it would be fair to spread it.
Is it to do with the Star Wars universe, or is it something you've heard about
me? It's totally
Are you
to
sure
do with...
you don't want to spread it here on Real Chat, Mark?
It might upset your listeners.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it could. Yeah.
And on that Star Wars bombshell, let's move on.
It is a bombshell, but maybe another time.
Mm. Okay. Do you guys have any favourite scenes from this film?
I love all the stuff with Yoda and that scene we just talked about where Luke first encounters him and he's going through all his stuff. And
see, nothing beats Hoth for me. I find that so exciting.
Yeah, I was going to say
the
that
best.
Too.
It's the best part of the movie.
Yeah.
When the AT-ATs, when they first appear, and it just, that is so scary. It's just, it's really quite frightening still. You know, you just see those massive forms coming towards you.
And they were upgraded a lot in the special edition, which we'll speak about a bit later, but because they were all stop motion originally.
Yeah.
So obviously when they did the special editions, they went back and put a lot of CG.
You know what's exciting about Hoth, I think, because it's a space battle on ground. It's like, it has references to World War II. It feels like we know it.
Yeah.
And it's exciting to see spaceships going around through snow. I don't know why. It's exciting. And the Stormtroopers got new gear.
The Stormtroopers are awesome. Yeah. How cool are they? They should have stuck with that. They're just like weird kind of bibs that they have.
The way the sets are lit, the steadier design of the world, the far clearer and less dubbed dialogue, the smoother editing and the all-round more polished feel makes Empire seem like it was made a decade after New Hope, in my opinion, not just 3 years. It's quite incredible. The line delivery is also far tighter and more natural, leaving the prequels in the dust, that's for sure. You believe these characters.
It's a lot more succinct,
Yes, definitely. So do you guys get that feel with this film as well?
Yeah, out of everything, it's the most polished.
Oh, for sure, absolutely,
Okay. Do you guys think that this film is more for kids or adults?
It's moving into an adult audience, definitely, at this point. The first film is very childlike, I think, very simple. The story is very simple, and it's told very plainly, whereas this is moving into more adult ideas, adult concepts. Just the romance angle is a lot more adult and played out.
The complexities between characters, I mean, that's stuff that kids wouldn't really engage with, I wouldn't have thought.
But there's still enough there for kids. And if, you know, if you break the film down, there's the Hoth at the start, there's Yoda in the middle, there's the Cloud City stuff, and then the fight with Vader. So there's enough going on for kids to be interested, I think. Like, you were still wrapped up in it as a kid.
Absolutely. I think that Lucas is a smart guy. He'd have known the only way to get kids to the movies that would have gone with their parents. He's a family guy himself. It was aimed at multi-level, like a Pixar movie. You know that mums and dads are laughing at one thing, kids are laughing at the other. It's very cleverly done.
We'll get into it, Brose, when we look at the prequels as well. But they didn't know what they were going for. They didn't know what demographic they were looking for with those ones. No idea.
No. The prequels are like the PG era of the WWE. They just had no fucking idea whatsoever.
Like, I don't even think they knew who that was catered for. Like, maybe George Lucas himself. Maybe
it was. I think Lucas made those films for himself and didn't really. He'd kind of disregarded anything else on the exterior.
Stay tuned, everybody. We will be looking at.
If you're sick of us all agreeing about how great this film is, wait till we get onto the prequels and you can hear us all agreeing about how shit they are.
Yeah. Can't wait. Now, just quickly, before we move past Boba Fett as well, I just have to make mention of one of the part that I find really humorous, right? You guys remember when the doors open and there stands Darth Vader at the end of the table? Then there's the whole...
We would be honored if you would join us.
And then out comes Boba Fett. You can blatantly tell that Vader said, right... Just want you to hide around this corner for a second because we'll have more impact if it's just me. No, seriously, get back there. I don't care how cool your gun or your outfit looks. Stand back there and then jump out and yell surprise or something.
You never know. He might have been, Boba Fett was out washing his hands before dinner or,
And when the stormtroopers come in the back, you think they're going to break in a dance or something, like a Busby and Berkeley scenario.
Yeah. So what do you guys think of the open-ended ending of the film and the fact that this film is essentially a bridging movie? It has definitely has that feel. Every franchise ever in the year 2015, we were expecting an ending like Empire Strikes Back has. But back then in 1980, this was something that was unheard of. And an ending like this would have had all sorts of different effects on different people. What do you guys think about this, maybe thinking back to that time, and how you feel about it now?
What did you think about it at the time?
I think that immediately it was like, oh, it's over, disappointment. I don't think that I would have been judging it very harshly, and I still don't. I think it's bridging, it's perfect. There's so much in that movie. How much more can you take?
Yeah.
There's so much about the characters, about the story, everything that you didn't know,
you know about
with Empire. Yeah. What do you do with the finish of it? You can't. It's not like a cliff. Your cliffhanger wouldn't have worked. It would have been cheesy.
It was. This would have been the, well,
in a way,
the shock.
The Carbonite Han Solo was a kind of a cliffhanger as well. So there's a little bit of that element. Although you just assumed he was dead.
No, we knew he was alive.
Yeah.
Yeah, it is. Well, you know that we're going to come back, especially with the whole father, son, and sister revelations in the next film, right? Yeah.
Oh yeah, it's just the shock of the fact that they don't win in the end. The good guys lose, and Han Solo's in, you know, a mystery cloud, and you know, you're probably still getting over that before you can even actually kind of think, oh, is that a good enough ending?
I reckon the ending must have left kids in 1980 crying and bewildered.
I reckon.
There's no medal ceremony. There's no party. There's no wedding. Chewie and Lando depart on a scouting mission that may not pay off.
Lando's smiling though.
Oh, he's always
smiling. That's true.
Luke is damaged and trying his best to heal. Leia just realized that she loves a man who she may never see again. And the fleet they rejoin seems pitifully unequipped to take on the might of the Empire that's hounded and ravaged them throughout the past two episodes. When you think about this, it really is quite a down ending, particularly compared to the ending of both the first and third films.
Yeah, very exciting. I was just thinking some negative points of Empire I could think of straight away. Two worst things.
We need some.
Luke's severed arm scene, I think, is appalling.
Oh, yeah?
And at a moment you can tell he's actually got in the suit, looks like one thing, actually stitched longer than the other, and you can see the bulk of a fist in it, which was disappointing. And also the terrible effect of when he gets sucked down into the big garbage wind tunnel chute, whatever that is, when he falls off, he looks like he's on a table on all fours.
the blue screen.
He looks like he's just sort of like, I'll just hold this position. It comes out really badly.
The other problem I've got with that sequence is the score is really awful.
Come with me. It is the only way.
And it's kind of a bit
Wizard of Oz.
It's a bit Wizard of Oz, a bit Charlie and the Chocolate Factory. It's just really cheesy piece of music from John Williams there.
You know, they added in a scream in the special edition there as well.
Is it the scream?
The Wilhelm?
You talk about the famous Wilhelm scream.
Yes, is it the Wilhelm?
It's not, but they did take it from another part of the trilogy. Did you know that?
Oh, there you go, no.
The Emperor falling down.
Oh, wow. At
the end of Return of the Jedi.
They used the Emperor's scream for Skywalker.
Scream for Skywalker. In the special edition.
Does it mean something?
No idea. It's almost like they couldn't get their hands on another scream and so they just pulled it from that because it doesn't even sound anything like Mark Hamill.
No, Mark Hamill doesn't know. Unless Mark Hamill did the original scream for the Emperor, and then they just...
I mean, he had a cold when he fell off. So during the mid-air flight, he got a cold and
perhaps
it was a bit husky.
Yes.
after the car accident, his vocal cords and his screamings...
Never screamed the same way
never
again.
Never did again.
Mm. Very shortly, Brose, we are going to get into the fact that there are as many versions of Empire Strikes Back as there was of A New Hope, and it changed numerous times over the years for every home release. One of the most interesting things is who originally played the Emperor in this film, because they changed it in the special edition. Did you guys know this?
Yeah.
The Emperor was played by an uncredited older woman named Elaine Baker and voiced by Kiwi actor Clive Revel. To make the character appear stranger and more unsettling, a chimpanzee's eyes were superimposed over the actress's face by the Industrial Light Magic effects crew.
Wow.
That's the whole like yellow eye effect. For the DVD release, a slightly altered version of the scene was shot using Ian McDermott. who played the character for the sequel, Return of the Jedi, as well as the three prequel films. The altered scene that features McDermott changed some of the dialogue as well. So this is one of those things where when you look at the series as a whole, it's not a change you can be unhappy about because of the visual continuity with the character.
Lucas made changes from the films between their theatrical release and then their VHS release, and then he'd make changes from there for their TV release. And so when we discuss the Star Wars one, it's hard to define what the New Hope version is on that DVD.
Right.
It's a Laserdisc version, but where that came from, it's not easy to work out. So I'm not sure if those changes are on.
We'll get into it, Brose, because the amount of different versions of this film, it's mind-boggling. But just quickly as well, there is another. To whom do you think Yoda is referring to?
Leia.
Yeah, Leia.
Right? By the time the original trilogy is released, with audiences having seen the movie sequel Return of the Jedi, it seems obvious that Yoda is speaking about Leia. However, at the time that The Empire Strikes Back was written and released, Leia was not meant to be Luke's sister, and one potential storyline in George Lucas's earlier notes was that Luke had an unnamed sibling also undergoing Jedi training on the opposite side of the galaxy.
How convenient.
It's also possible that line was inserted to open up the possibility that Luke may die in his confrontation with Vader in order to add suspense.
Well, that Mark Hamill was such a bad actor that they just thought they might get rid of him.
There is another. We've got Eric Stoltz training, so that'll work out very well.
Imagine that movie.
Oh, dear. Yeah.
Or Eric Roberts.
Eric Roberts would be even better.
Did you guys see the inserted visual effects shot of a tennis shoe in one of the space scenes? Did you guys?
No, I didn't pick that up.
I've looked at that. That's really hard. I think it's true, but it's hard to define.
What's the shot?
The shoe actually appears during the asteroid field sequence. It can be seen tumbling from the upper left to lower right of the frame in the exterior shot immediately following Han's when he sort of proclaims that he's going in closer to one of the big ones. Have you seen this at all, Andrew?
Oh, I missed it, I must admit.
It's just one of those weird things like this, like the stormtrooper hitting his head in the first one. Just one of those. I don't know why they put it in there, like a gag or something.
Yeah, I just don't know if it's an urban myth or it's real. But I've seen a steel frame of it, and it does look like a tennis shoe. But whether you can pick it,
it's like
moving.
In Raiders of the Lost Ark when they said that there's C-3PO and R2-D2 and the hieroglyphics and where they find the Ark of the Covenant. It's apparently mixed in with the.
It wouldn't surprise me.
Yeah, I've never seen it.
It's also true that Harrison Ford came up with the line, "I know," after Leia says to him, "I love you," which is just one of the great moments in this film. During the scene of the carbon freezing, Leia says, "I love you" to Han, and was supposed to say, "I love you" back. The director, Irvin Kershner, felt that Han saying "I love you" did not sound right, so Ford came up with the response, "I know." George Lucas wanted to keep Han's "I love you," but Kershner decided not to. Good call there.
Well, the way Kershner tells the story in the commentary that they'd done, I don't know, 18 or 19 takes, it was just before lunch break or the wrapping for the day, and he still wasn't happy with the energy, he wasn't happy with the way the dialogue ran, and then I think Harrison Ford, who was just jack of doing another take of it, just quipped, "I know," and as soon as Kershner heard it, he rapped and said, "Yep, that's it, we're done, print, let's move on." And the crew apparently rebelled and said, "But you haven't got a good version of the take, you haven't got the take with the right dialogue," and Kershner's like, "No, I've got it, don't worry about it, let's move on." So, yeah.
Lucas was afraid that people would laugh at that comment, that they wouldn't get the gap, wouldn't get the meaning behind that.
It's almost like he didn't understand Han Solo as well as Kershner.
I wouldn't be surprised.
There's nothing funny about the way that line is delivered. I find it's part of the best part of the romantic part of that whole film.
Yeah.
That he said that.
And then it gets a call back in Jedi, doesn't it? Leia gets to throw it back at him in Jedi? No? Okay, I'm making shit up.
I think we just have to wait till we all watch that one again. Yeah. Bruce. Also, guys, do you guys know what the Imperial AT-AT Walkers movements are based on?
I did know.
A rhinoceros?
Very close. An elephant.
Oh, well, there you go.
The effects artist first used animation to decide what movements were best for the walkers and decided elephants' gaits look best because they are slow and mechanical. The movements from the hand-drawn animation were copied when the stop-motion was created for the walker scenes on Hoth. The slow, elephant-like movements gave the giant walkers a sense of scale and an ominous, creepy presence as they moved towards the rebel stronghold. So there you go.
I have one. I've got one of the
Yes, of course.
Have you built one, Mark?
No, I bought the Kenner off a collector.
Because we had a look at some of your Facebook shots and some of the work that you put together, and they're amazing, mate.
That's just a little hobby thing that I'm doing now. I didn't really do much of that. I've got a lot of the toys at home, which my kids now enjoy, so they're not like in glass cabinets or anything.
What are you doing?
Because they were my toys when I was a kid.
What are their condition like now then?
Some of them are good, some of them are pretty ordinary.
Okay. Yeah.
Well, if you want to swap out any of those characters for the Phantom Menace re-release ones and put yours on the last cover, yeah. As someone who's selling some.
Just on the AT-ATs briefly, one of my favourite time-lapse scenes of a behind-the-scenes things is the animating of the AT-ATs. It's awesome.
Yes.
With all the pop-up.
Check it out.
Guys popping up.
Oh, yeah, yeah, on the landscape. It's fantastic. They've got trapdoors so they can pop up and do it.
Just a little bit of trivia here from The Empire Strikes Back. The shots where Luke uses his Jedi powers to retrieve his lightsaber from a distance were achieved by having Mark Hamill throw the lightsaber away and then running the film in reverse. So nice little, pretty basic bit of camera trickery there, Brose.
Very simple, very simple.
When Han Solo is about to be frozen, Princess Leia says, "I love you." In the original script, Han Solo was supposed to say, "Just remember that, Leia, because I'll be back."
Oh, wow.
I'll be back.
But at the time of filming, Harrison Ford wasn't entirely certain he would be back for the third film. So, Han Solo is the only... I think you mentioned this before, Andrew. Han Solo is the only non-Jedi Sith in the entire original trilogy to ever wield a lightsaber, which he used to cut open the Tauntaun's belly.
Disappointing. Had so much potential, really.
You saw some talent there.
Oh, it's a waste.
Being a young child who's kind of obsessed with blood and guts and sort types of things and finding them hilarious, when that Tauntaun get cut open, like, if that was on TV, Empire Strikes Back, you'd yell out in the house, "Quick, get to the TV, it's gonna be on!" And we'd all crowd around to watch that bit. It was the best bit of the movie.
How cool is that? It's so realistic.
It's so good. Yeah, it's fantastic.
To preserve the dramatic opening of the Star Wars movies, George Lucas insisted on moving all the credits to the end of the film. However, the Writers Guild and Directors Guild had begrudgingly allowed this on Star Wars Episode 4, A New Hope, because that film wasn't expected to be very successful. They resented the trend being continued on this film. First, they tried to pull Empire from release, but were unsuccessful. They then fined Lucas heavily and tried to fine Irvin Kershner. But Lucas paid all the fines himself, apparently $250,000 worth.
Wow.
Lucas then bitterly dropped his membership in the Writers Guild, Directors Guild, and the Motion Picture Association of America, a move that has hindered his hiring choices on later films.
So interestingly, I was listening to an interview with Robert Rodriguez recently, and he handed in his Directors Guild card recently.
Yep.
So when he directed Sin City, he wanted Frank Miller as a co-director. But there's some weird rule within the Directors Guild that you can't have a co-director who is a first-time director. They have to have directed something first before they can be a co-director. Mm. And he spoke to Lucas about it, where he was doing post-production at Lucas's ranch for one of his other films, and Lucas just said, "Stuff him, hand your card back in." So he did.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, and he hasn't looked back since. So, yeah.
Is that why Soderbergh does it as well? Because he shoots his own films, so he's got his alias.
Yeah, maybe, yeah.
Peter Andrews, I think, is his alias for his camera work.
When he does DOP stuff.
Yeah. They're sticklers, aren't they?
Yeah.
In the original script, when Lando is about to lead Han, Leia, and Chewie into the trap set by Darth Vader, Lando offers his arm to Leia as a gesture to lead her down the hallway as she accepts it. Harrison Ford ad-libbed Han coming up behind Leia and offering his arm to her at the exact same time to imply that Han was jealous. nice little touch there from Harrison Ford. The carbon freezing chamber is the only time in the original trilogy that Darth Vader and C-3PO can be seen on screen together.
Oh, wow.
That's interesting.
Yep.
Wow, removing any doubt that they are the same person.
But he was on the back of Chewie at the time, right, looking the wrong way.
That's right. Yeah.
How humiliating.
In each Star Wars film, the line, "I have a bad feeling about this," is spoken by one of the characters. In this film, it's Leia's turn.
Oh, there you go. Is that in all six films as well?
Yeah. You know what? I actually don't know, but definitely the original
three.
There's
a good chance it is.
It probably is.
That's what I said just as I went in to see the second prequel. I have a bad feeling about this.
Actually, I think this is what you were talking about before here, Mark. The scenes where R2-D2 is submerged in the mud pool were shot in George Lucas's unfinished swimming pool.
Oh, there you go.
Most of the crew were hidden under the water, and the entire sequence was shot by Lucas himself. There you go.
Uh-huh.
There you are. Another directing job for him on this film.
Luke is separated from most of the main characters for the majority of this film, as we sort of mentioned before as well. In fact, the only scene that has all of the main Rebel characters together is in the hospital bed scene. That's it.
Yeah, fairly sterile kind of scene too.
Yep, it is. So, Brose, let's talk a little bit about, I mean, again, listen to our first Star Wars episode if you want to get a bit of an idea of how many different versions there are of the first Star Wars film on both DVD, Blu-ray, VHS, Laserdisc, everything. It's been released
every
that many
format.
Times.
Yeah.
So just quickly, a little bit on the different versions that have come out. The first one on DVDs is as far back as we're going to go here, Brose. We're not going back to
So that were 97?
No.
No, before then?
No, 2004.
Was it that late?
Star Wars didn't come out until on DVD until 2004.
Well, see, one of the things I found out in lead up to this, too, as far as I can find out, you can't buy the individual films, the original films, on Blu-ray. You can only buy them in the box set. Is that right?
Yep.
Yes, correct.
Yeah, which is really frustrating.
So it was originally came out on DVD in September 2004, bundled in a box set with A New Hope and Return of the Jedi and a bonus disc of features. The films were digitally restored and remastered with additional changes made by George Lucas from the 1997 versions. There was further alterations made.
More tinkering. Nice. Yeah.
Again, go back and listen to the first Star Wars episode, everyone, if you want to hear all about the tinkering, because we really covered that in quite a lot of detail. And then, like I said, Lucas made changes that were mostly implemented to ensure continuity between The Empire Strikes Back and the recently released prequel trilogy. With this release, Lucas also supervised the creation of a high-definition digital print of Empire and the original trilogy's other films. It was reissued in December 2005 as part of a 3-disc limited edition box set that did not feature the bonus disc, otherwise it was identical. And then, Brose, which I think you've got a copy of, the 2006 theatrical non-anamorphic releases.
Yes, that's what I've got.
On a bonus second disc along with the 2004 version.
Yeah, that's what I've got, yeah.
So just quickly again, non-anamorphic for people who don't understand what that is.
Well, I assume it refers non-anamorphic.
It's the fact that it's like
letterbox 4:3.
Yes.
So it's a 4:3 image with the letterbox across the, you know, the letterbox top and bottom.
The black bars at the top and the bottom are part of the image. They're not created by your TV.
Correct.
To preserve the right aspect ratio. So in order to watch it on a widescreen TV in the right resolution, you have to watch it in a little box inside the TV.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah. When I first watched it, I did you can do it like an artificial zoom on the TV that I had, and it was back in the CRT days, so it looked fine. And then watching it again on my current television, it looked fine. It's a little bit muddy, a little bit dirty around the edges, but it's allowed to be. It's a 35-year-old film, so I don't mind it.
This is put on a second disc, though, as a special feature. So the original versions of the movies.
It's pretty much the only special feature on that DVD set. There's the commentary on the 2004 version, and then there's that earlier release. So what release is that one, did you say again?
The 2006.
But what's the... Is it the original theatrical? Or is it the original theatrical that was tinkered with before the Laserdisc?
No, it is the original theatrical, but it's from a Laserdisc print.
Right.
So the print is very old, and by today's standards, it looks very, very ordinary.
Yeah, it didn't bother me too much because I'm watching the film that I grew up with.
I think it's because you just know it's the only way you can watch it.
And before that, I think the copy of Empire I had was taped off Channel 10 on an old VHS tape. So,
nice.
Yeah, I think they're absolutely...
That's true. I think our generation grew up with that kind of fuzzy quality of the film.
Yeah.
And then in 2011, obviously, the films were altered again and finally released on Blu-ray. That there were more tinkerings to the special editions.
Does anyone have those 2011 Blu-rays? Do you have the Blu-rays?
Yes, I've got 4, 5, 6.
I do.
I'm keen to pick them up, but I just haven't got there.
What's the image quality like? Is it?
Oh, that's brilliant.
It's brilliant. Yeah. It's fantastic.
Someone said that actually shows up the dodginess of the sets and the spaceships and stuff.
A little bit, but I don't really hold that against the movie.
No, I think all the spaceship stuff, they've been so cleaned up, matte or cleaned up, that they look better than ever.
Yeah. Well, I'll have to check it out.
And then the most recent news in regards to releases is the digital release, Brose, which came out this year.
Yeah.
The Walt Disney Studios, now they've got their hands on it. And Lucasfilm jointly announced the digital release of all 6 Star Wars films via Amazon.com and Vudu. Now, Brose, these DVDs and Blu-rays as well feature, I think, 2 audio commentaries. Now, you checked out one of them, is that right?
Yeah, from what I can work out, there was an earlier commentary, and the one that I listened to, which is on the 2006 release, is parts of the original one, and then they've put new bits in as well.
Okay, yeah.
That's my understanding from the research I did, but you may have different information. So the commentary I listened to had Ben Bird, George Lucas, Kirshner, Carrie Fisher, and I think there's a 5th voice in there, but he doesn't say much. I can't remember
Carrie Fisher
was.
Wouldn't
make Boba Fett,
sense.
Wasn't it?
No.
It was, it might have been Boba or Boba Fett. I'm not sure.
What's it like? What's his commentary like?
It's actually pretty good. Kirshner is amazing in this film, and he remembers everything crisply, and just listening to his directorial choices, and it's really fascinating. If you're a fan of this film, without a doubt, if you haven't heard Kirshner talk about it, and up until this commentary was recorded, he hadn't talked about this film. It was all George Lucas. It was all Lucas says this, Lucas says that, all the press, all the behind-the-scenes stuff, everything is about Lucas, and Kirshner wasn't really known. So to hear Kirshner talk about the choices he made and the decisions he made as a director is really interesting and quite fascinating, and I mean, it just shows you why this film has as much depth as it does, and it's a lot of it is Kirshner. And he's very funny. He comes across very charismatic and very funny. Lucas is good because Lucas talks a little bit more about his writing process, so he doesn't get bogged down in the obviously because he wasn't there for the shooting of it. So he talks about the writing and he talks about some of the post-production stuff. So Lucas is a lot more tolerable. He gets a little bit annoying in the Star Wars one, I think. Carrie Fisher doesn't say much, but she has a couple of really nice anecdotes, as she is good at telling anecdotes. And Ben Burtt doesn't have as much to say because I think the audio work was kind of done already. He does mention a couple of quirky little bits where the squeaking, I think, of the AT-AT's legs was a garbage dumpster out the front of his house and all those kind of found sounds that he talks about. The snow speeders in Hoth were him recording a freeway in L.A. through a vacuum tube. So that's why you get that kind of warped kind of sound. And the... what was the other characters? There's another creature in there. Might have been the Tauntauns are some type of French otter that he recorded at the zoo and then slowed down and to give an extra bass to give it that deeper kind of noise. Yeah. So I love, when he talks about that stuff, it's electric. It's great because he just put so much work into finding those sounds. But by now, he'd already have a full library of Chewbacca sounds, a full library of R2 sounds, and I mean, the work he does with those characters alone is magnificent. So this is a really good fun... It starts a bit slow, like a lot of commentaries do, but because they record everybody individually and then edit together and create a piece of entertainment, it's a really good way to create a commentary, and it's really informative. So it's great. Right. It's easily a 4-star commentary.
I was just going to ask you what you're reading.
Easily a 4-star commentary.
You know, it's interesting. We'll never know what the details were between the contract that's been signed by Lucas and Disney. I think it's very, very interesting. We need to petition Disney to get a box set release with the original, I've got a Blade Runner box set, which I love.
Yeah, I love that box set.
Every version of the film, which I care deeply about. I want this for Star Wars.
Mark, do me a favor. Go and listen to our Star Wars episode. You'll get all this information in great detail, my friend.
No, well, Lucas still claims that he's lost the negatives or whatever, and he's full of shit because he hasn't lost anything in his life. His way during the prequels.
Now, Andrew, let's talk about John Williams' epic and iconic score for The Empire Strikes Back. Where on earth do you start with this one?
This is
all the Star Wars films, or the majority of them, have fantastic scores, but this has got to be number one. At least it is for me.
Yeah, no, I think absolutely. It's the golden period for John Williams' career, I think. Like, right when he did this film, he'd just done Superman, and I think Raiders of the Lost Ark was next, and then E.T. was after that. I mean, that's staggering output in a space of a couple of years. So, you know,
Superman
was
before this as well.
Superman was before, yeah, and then Star Wars was before that. So, yeah, just incredible, really. And I think when we did the Star Wars, we mentioned how there was a lot of reference to classical pieces, and I think he would have obviously been instructed to kind of lean on those when he was composing the score. But with this film, he's really come into his own. I think he's, not used a lot of the themes from the first film. He's created a whole bunch of new themes.
Led, of course, by the Imperial March.
Your very favourite. And
I love that piece of music.
It's an amazing piece of music. I mean, that, Yoda's theme, Han and Leia's love theme. I mean, they're the three themes that just propel the narrative forward and create the emotion throughout the whole film. And the performance of the London Symphony Orchestra is just amazing. And just the quality of the writing, like the textures and sounds he gets out of just the orchestra alone, like these alien kind of soundscapes that he creates with these, I don't know what the instruments are, but you know, a lot of the sound effects within the worlds are his music, not so much Ben Burtt's sound effects. So they really aid the worlds that we live in the film. And you just hope that kind of craftsmanship comes back into film scoring, because it's just a beautiful fine art that's created there.
It's one of the great things about the Star Wars films, and I mean, it's almost by accident, but the fact they shot in England and then have access to the London Symphony Orchestra just makes all of Williams' work just explode on screen. Like, I've got a version of the score done by it's the Skywalker Orchestra, directed by John Williams, and it doesn't have any of the energy that the original London Symphony does, and it's just, I guess, you know, just a lucky benefit of shooting in the UK, having access to them. And you're right, the performances are just exceptional.
I actually have I have 4, 5, and 6 audio CDs in a box set thing. I love them. Mm. I love them dearly, but it's, A New Hope is, I think, better, but I hear what you're saying about Empire.
Yeah.
Interestingly, he said recently he's not going backwards for any of the references for any of the stuff he's doing for 7. So you might see another creative explosion.
That'd be amazing, wouldn't it?
Yeah, it's going to be Star Wars, of course, but he was saying, I haven't listened to any of that stuff. I'm not even going to the notes.
Is that what he said?
Yeah, he's already said that about it.
Yep.
It's just the fact that he's exciting. Doing them is...
The fact that he's alive is exciting. How can he be alive? Some of them about to fall off the perch, surely, right?
Yeah, he's old.
He's not going back to the original Star Wars films for reference, but he has been playing a lot of Dark Forces. So, just let that sit.
This is a video game that gets mentioned a lot on this show. Dark Forces have been brought up about five times.
Dark Forces and Lego Star Wars are the only two Star Wars games I've ever played. So,
oh, wow. They like them both.
They're the only... I love them both. They're the only references I've got. Yeah. And how many were there? 53 Star Wars video games over the last... 832 of them?
Oh, a new one on the horizon too.
Is there another one? Yeah, Battlefront's coming. Yeah.
And do you like the Imperial March piece of music, Andrew?
Yeah, no, it's iconic, isn't it? It's just, you know...
Straight out of Nazi Germany.
Isn't it? It's been parodied a lot as well. One of my favourite uses of it was when it used for like 4 or 5 seconds in The Simpsons just for the shot of Mr. Burns sitting at his desk. It's fantastic.
I think the Yoda's theme, I love Yoda's theme, and that's just a great, majestic theme for that character. And it really balances the darkness of the hardness of the Darth Vader theme, and you've got this light, kind of dreamy theme for Yoda, and it just they play off each other. And, you know, John Williams does a great job in the end credits of weaving the themes into each other, into this suite at the end.
Doing like a end credits suite, yeah.
Yeah, he's fantastic. So good at doing that. And it's just, if you need one piece of music from the score, that is, you know, just a great kind of embodiment of the whole thing.
And it's been released about as many times as the film's been released as well, hasn't it, Andrew?
Yeah, similar story to all the other scores in the trilogies, trilogy.
Came out on vinyl and cassette in 1980.
Yeah, inevitably it would have been vinyl and cassette.
But it was only 10 tracks. It's been expanded dramatically since then.
Yeah, that's right. And then it was, the Fox Classics, 20th Century Fox box set was the first major one.
Is that the one that you've got?
That's the one I've got. And that was like, when I saw that in the shop window, I was like, it exists. You can actually get it because it was so hard to find before that was released. And that's a great box set. And then they came out with the RCA Victor version, which had this amazing cloth bound. I'm not sure if that's the one you've got, but it's beautiful, you know, packaging and, you know, full liner notes and all the, just the full score, all the unreleased stuff, everything you'd want from the films. So that was a collector's item, which is now discontinued. And then they re-released it with RCA again.
Was that when the DVDs came out?
I think it was the same time. Yeah. And it was, you know, cheaper packaging. It was just a normal jewel case. And then finally Sony bought the rights to the music and pretty much just did what RCA Victor did and repackaged it with the Sony badge. So, bloody cheapskates.
But is the versions that are available now, or the most recent ones, are they like fairly complete?
Yeah, as far as I know, I think it's everything that featured in the film, and then more. There's like, you know, unreleased cues and alternate cues as well. So, yeah, it's so fortunate now that you can get all this stuff. I mean,
it's remastered as well,
and it sounds amazing.
But is there a piece of score for the Vader Skywalker fight in this film that wasn't used, or was it not a piece ever written?
I don't think there was.
Okay, that's interesting.
In my listening, I've never heard it. But as
you know, I was thinking about that scene before when we were saying it was just sound effects. There's a sound effect, a drone in that, which also appears in Blade Runner and Alien, and I think there's a tie-in with the guys who did the sound effects. And I'm such a nerd, I actually recreated that sound effect at home on a synthesizer.
Really?
Just to do it, because I like it so much. It's the tone that goes...
You mentioned Blade Runner,
it's
right?
It's in Blade Runner and Alien, yeah.
Yeah, I don't know what you mean.
You had to be a complete nerd to hear.
Yes.
That means everyone at this table.
It's really relaxing.
If anybody listening to Real Chat has been nerdy enough to recreate sound effects on their home synthesizer, let us know.
I say please leave the room.
No, you're welcome.
I find when a long, hard day at work that unwinds me when I listen to that, though. Just have it on loop.
Nice.
Did your recreation do the original justice?
It's perfect.
Oh, fantastic.
Spot on. Don't doubt the Horpinitch.
Might get him to send it to me before we do the editing of this episode.
So we can pop it in?
Pop it in. Bit of a clip.
You'll have to perform it for us.
Challenge accepted.
I like to actually just make phone calls and do Darth Vader's heavy breathing to people. I get a kick out of it.
Yeah, yeah. How many restraining orders do you have now?
17.
Yeah, 17. Nice. The force is strong with you. Do you do the heavy breathing and then you say, would you like to feel the force? And then you hang up. I know what you're like.
Any fan of Empire Strikes Back's music has got to track down one of these releases, though, without a doubt.
Oh, definitely, yeah. It's just, as we said, it's great that you have access to all that score now.
Now, just quickly, and just in regards to alternate versions, there are a lot, every DVD and home video release that came out altered something, but obviously the major changes were done in 1997 when George Lucas re-released the complete Star Wars trilogy with some updated digital effects and new or expanded scenes.
What are the... I found when I watched, because I watched both versions for this, and I found it a lot less offensive than the changes he made to A New Hope.
The reason for that...
Thank God for that.
I think the reason for that, Brose, is the fact that of the three, Empire's had the fewest changes.
Okay, well, that makes sense too. There's still one or two that kind of irked me a little bit, a little bit jarring, but generally it was all right.
The prominent changes include the expanded scene with the Wampa, the creature that attacks Luke.
Yeah, see, I didn't like that at all.
Yeah.
I find those wide shots of the Wampa eating before he looks over at Luke and stuff just forced and clunky. And Lucas says in the commentary, oh, we finally were able to produce a suit that looked authentic enough. And it's just the great thing about the Wampa is that you don't see him. And he's camouflaged into the snow and he's a very scary kind of creature. And then having pictures of him eating, it looks like he's sitting on a toilet and eating a piece of pizza. And it kind of just looked a bit too ridiculous and a bit overblown.
Have you seen the scene that was deleted from the film where he breaks through the wall?
Is this from the original?
Yeah.
No.
It's appalling. It's really bad. So there's a scene where the Wampa actually crashes into the Hoth base as Han and Leia are trying to escape.
Oh, God,
and it's the reason that wall collapses.
Oh, right.
Of ice.
Oh, okay.
And it's like the worst outtake you've ever seen. I'm so glad it was dropped.
It's one of the things that we've mentioned before, but Lucas doesn't quite get that his limitations of what made him great at this time. And the fact that he couldn't create a Wampa fully imagined Wampa on screen is what makes the Wampa kind of great in a way. It becomes more of a horror character, and it works.
It's the whole shark in Jaws thing.
Exactly,
it's implied
more
than the scene.
Or alien, you know,
so much more powerful.
So, I don't like the Wampa sequence as much.
Also, expanded shots of Cloud City in order to make the city look bigger and more crowded.
Yeah, that's the other one
that helped.
Well, there's a shot of Leia from the outside and through the window, which is a new shot, I think. It's kind of a big shot of Cloud.
Yeah, kind of the one you mean.
I found that a bit clunky. But
In the original, I always loved the dark, kind of empty corridors of Bespin when they're kind of trying to escape. And it's abandoned, and it just really added to this kind of creepy city it's now a ghost town. I just thought that was really effective. And, you know, putting in these window plates where there's just all this massive city, you know, happening, it's distracted me from that emotion I think you had. Yeah. So, a minor quibble, but...
They also put back a brief scene where Darth Vader returning to his Star Destroyer towards the end of the film.
That one was pretty funny. I thought that was pretty pointless.
It was just really just
bring my shuttle. Okay, I guess Darth Vader's leaving now.
Yeah.
But they do put back in the hologram conversation.
Yes.
Which I like. I like that bit. That's really nice.
The 2004 DVD release has further minor changes and enhancements, mostly cosmetic, such as color correction. So just little tinkerings by this stage. He'd really, you know, he was making changes, but they were a lot more minor.
Which is what he should have done in the first place. I discussed how much I hated the New Hope adjustments, and they're just irrelevant. They're bad filmmaking in some instances, and he didn't need to. There are elements he could have added, and he could have smoothed things out, and that's fine. But the big, massive changes, and again, that are just bad direction, is really frustrating.
I'm frightened for when we get to Return of the Jedi. That's going to be a massacre.
Yeah.
See, some of the Hollywood masters would just turn in their grave at the stuff that Lucas has done.
Oh,
he just cannot leave it alone.
And Spielberg, similarly with E.T. and things like that, are just reprehensible.
Mm. What do you guys think is the definitive version of these films?
There's so many changes, I don't really know.
Yeah.
And it's one of those things, if you go back and see, if you get the opportunity to go back and see it originally was, you wouldn't be happy. But you're not entirely happy with all of the changes that have been done now. But I think Empire, like you said, it's been cleaned up. That was the most important thing. That it was cleaned up and looks a lot better. And the changes are so subtle you don't notice. They're much greater in 4 and 6 where it's massive changes.
I don't know if I ever will get the version of Star Wars that I want, which is the original versions as they were seen in the cinemas, cleaned up to the level that Blu-ray technology can do these days.
Yeah. That'd be gold.
Yes, yeah. Exactly. What do you think, Andrew?
Yeah. Yeah, no, that's what I want. I mean, to me, the best ones are the ones that I remember from as a kid, and that's what I want to see. I don't want to be distracted by these, you know, touch-ups.
But cleaned up to the best of their...
I want to see a Blu-ray version of that. That's absolutely right.
Well, it exists somewhere, surely.
Of all three original films, I've seen those weird Laserdisc theatrical release versions the most. Either the TV edits from when I was a kid or VHS versions from when I was a kid or the DVD versions I've got now. I've seen maybe the remastered or 97, 2004 releases or whatever, maybe once or twice. Like, so all those changes and things aren't ingrained in my mind. The films still exist to me pretty much as they were the first time I saw them 30 years ago. So that's what I'd like to. Same.
Bruce, we could do a whole podcast on this, but collectibles for The Empire Strikes Back.
I already have a massive list of things here, but I might end up culling on the run. As I said in A New Hope, I'm only focusing on the figures that were released around the time of the film's release. I'm not going into anything else that's been released. In this instance, it's the period of 1980 to 1982. I'm not looking at anything post-1982 when the Jedi stamp was put on all the figures. And none of the re-releases and all that stuff, that's all separate. And we might even do a collectibles episode of Star Wars down the track where we can spend a good amount of time, a special episode, looking at everything else that's come since then. Because there's so much that's existed. But I still find the original story of the Star Wars figures very interesting, and there's still some information here that I discovered in doing research today that I didn't know about. And it's worth stepping back and decluttering and de-emphasizing everything else that's happened since these films were released, because without Star Wars, we wouldn't have a toy collectibles market that we do now. There's so many things that happened between 1977 and 1985 or 1986 created what I know now and we know now as a toy collectibles market. Star Wars Empire Strikes Back, basically from 77 to 1979, all the figures were badged Star Wars. From 1980 onwards, they were then rebranded Empire Strikes Back. So the original 21 figures, I think it was, the 21 figures originally released for Star Wars were just instantly rebranded Empire Strikes Back and put on the shelves. It's interesting, at this point, a few things have changed. In the collector's circles, Empire Strikes Back figures and then onwards are now referred to, or at least the Empire Strikes Back figures, are now referred by the number of figures listed on the back of the card. So each different series of figures that was released, that's how they're referred. So it's not series 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. So the original, there were 21 figures released, Star Wars rebranded, so that's known as the 21 back card series. From then, they added extra figures. Another 10 figures were added, so become the 31 card figure. After that, they re-released the figures again to the 32 back series. So they only added one extra figure between 31 and 32, and that was Yoda. So that makes sense. Yoda previously unreleased. From 32 backs, we went to the 41, 41 to 45. 45, I think, and we went up to 47 figures mentioned on the back. That didn't mean that we only had, say, between 21 and 47, 26 new figures. Some figures were dropped. So R2 and C-3PO were dropped very early and then replaced with variations later on. And different figures would come and go from the series as they were re-released to sell figures. A couple of significant things that are worth mentioning, and I guess this is the big thing that I discovered when doing the research for these figures. Everyone knows about variations of figures and that there were subtle variations between different figures that made them more collectible. One of the things that I've discovered is that it seems Kenner were aware of this and intentionally created variations in production runs to make them more collectible and to try and make collectors keep buying figures. So the big one is during the Star Wars run, they released a Han Solo that had an overlarge head, which I talked about in the last podcast, I think, and they adjusted that and gave him a better to scale head. When they released the Empire Strikes Back figures, they put the big head back on him. So all of a sudden, it went from collectors having the Star Wars Han Solo mint on card with the small big head to the small head, and then the Empire with the big head again. And they were hoping that collectors would essentially look at that and go, I've got the big-headed Han, but not with the Empire card. So there's a couple others from this series. Yoda had a green snake and then a brown snake. Luke Skywalker's hair keeps changing, blonde to brown to brown to blonde to blonde to brown for no reason. The biggest one that I found, which is absolutely fantastic, is that one of the Bespin, or the Bespin Guard, was released as a figure, and then in the next series, for no reason whatsoever, all of a sudden he's African-American. He goes from being a white man to being a black man. Never explained by anybody, but that was the change they made during production. So in the original run, there was a character called the Death Squad Commander, which is probably one of the darkest action figure names aimed at kids in the history of action figures. But that was then later renamed the Star Destroyer Commander, which is a lot more kiddie friendly.
Do you know, he looks nothing like the actual character in the movie either.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, nothing like him.
He's just a generic uniform.
Those guys like wore black. They had the visor and the full black helmet, and this guy, like a square cutout. It looks like he's got a crazy wig thing going on. Doesn't look anything like the real character.
Yeah, the figures are pretty ordinary at this stage.
Do you ever have the Darth Vader case where you could put your figurines into the case?
I didn't, but kid down the road did, yeah.
I used to covet it. You could travel with it everywhere. It was fantastic.
Yeah, they released a whole bunch of cases, but the Vader head was the most significant. There are a few other things that Kenner did, which I find very interesting to promote more sales. So one of the things they did later on was start releasing 3-packs, and I think there were multi-packs with more figures in them. But what they would do is put 2 figures that were already released with a third figure that hadn't been released yet to force people to buy doubles to get that one figure that they were missing. So they did things like that as well. Oh, and then the final, I know, like...
They did their own theme, like, you know, the Empire's theme, Kenner, I think.
But the other thing that's significant, though, is this is the first time a toy manufacturer went to this level when they had fans that were obsessed enough to buy figures, multiple figures, to get different variations on things, which is, this is the dawn of, this is kind of the very capitalist toy manufacturing ideology, I guess, but it's the first time it kind of existed. One of the mail away offers they had was a little plastic stand that you could then put in a cardboard print of a backdrop from Empire Strikes Back, except what they did was when you mailed away your 5 proof of purchases, they sent you 1 plastic stand and 8 backdrops. So then kids would buy more figures to get more proof of purchases to send away to get enough stands so they could set up their figures in front of the 8 different backdrops from the film. And the last mail away figure that was released as Empire Strikes Back was a figure of Admiral Akbar, who was then obviously planned to appear in Return of the Jedi. However, the early Admiral Akbar figures that were sent out had the insert card featuring Revenge of the Jedi, and that's highly collectible as well, which was then too. The final film was finally renamed Return of the Jedi. Those were changed, and the later Admiral Akbars were changed to go with it.
Well, why didn't the Kenner guys just go door knocking and just get the kids, turn them upside down and just shake them?
Shake the money out of them.
That's really all they wanted to achieve, really, isn't it?
It's quite interesting that the way that I guess Kenner started thinking outside the box in terms of how do we get more money out of people than just releasing a basic set. And I mean, they had a license to print money, and they definitely took advantage of it as much as they could.
What do you think about the sort of pre-release of the Star Wars toys for Episode 7, which happened a bit early?
Yeah, I this part of my blackout, I haven't even looked yet. So Lego is so far ahead at the moment with all the licensing stuff that some of the films that have had Lego sets have had spoilers in the Lego set if you paid too much attention. So I don't want to look at any of the Star Wars Lego stuff or any of the action. I don't want to know anything about the film that I can, if I can help it. So I haven't had a look yet, but I got caught up in Phantom Menace, and I've got a lot of pre-release Phantom Menace figures that I shouldn't have even bothered.
Maybe ask him after we look at Episode 7.
Sure.
One of the last episodes of the year will be, bro.
It will be, yeah. Wait until you walk into my apartment and you find it surrounded, completely filled with Force Awakens crap. So, you know, see what happens then.
I think it'll determine whether or not Brose liked the film or not.
The other thing worth mentioning just quickly, Empire Strikes Back, I think, if not the first time, a more expanded release of the 12-inch figures that Star Wars became famous for later on. And then as the Vader and different... kind of collector boxes to store them in. But yeah, just focusing on a small element of the releases, there's a lot more, obviously, release for Star Wars replica of prop guns and things and lightsabers and things. But the action figures are quite interesting.
That was epic, bro. Thank you very much indeed.
That was the cut-down version.
Yeah. I know. That's, like you said, bro, you could do an entire episode on Star Wars collectibles. Yeah. Just quickly in regards to the awards for Empire Strikes Back, at the Academy Awards in 1981, it won the Oscar for Best Sound. And it also won a Special Achievement Award for Visual Effects to the effects team as well. In regards to nominations, it was nominated for Best Art Direction Set Decoration and also nominated for Best Music Original Score to John Williams, like it should have.
Johnny.
At the Golden Globes in 1981, it was nominated Best Original Score for Motion Picture to John Williams. It was its only nomination.
Wow.
As well. At the Grammy Awards in 1981, it won Best Album of Original Score Written for a Motion Picture or Television Special to John Williams. And it was nominated for the Grammy for Best Pop Instrumental Performance for John Williams, the London Symphony Orchestra, for Yoda's Theme.
Wow.
Pop.
Yeah.
Grammys.
Yeah.
Wow.
Amazing,
huh? That's
bizarre.
Imagine that now.
I know.
What would Kanye West say about it?
He'd do his own remix of it, yeah. I think.
I'm just going to stop you there. I'm just going to stop you for a second. Yeah.
at the good old Saturn's Brose, which are the awards which we hold in
Surely Empire Strikes Back cleaned up that year.
Well, let's have a look, shall we? It won the Saturn Awards for Best Science Fiction Film, Best Actor, Mark Hamill.
What?
Best Director, Irvin Kershner, and Best Special Effects to Brian Johnson and Richard Edlund. Nominated at the Saturn Awards, Brose, for Best Supporting Actor, Billy Dee Williams.
Wow.
Best Writing to Lee Brackett and Lawrence Kasdan. Best Music to John Williams. And Best Costumes to John Mollo. So, what's that, Brose? That's 4 wins and 4 nominations for Empire Strikes Back.
Yeah, I'm just going to have a look here. What year were the Saturns for that? It was
1981.
Oh, 81. Hang on, let me pull these up. I want to see who John Williams lost the frigging Saturn to.
That's a very good point. We did that when we looked at
Jerry Goldsmith.
Total Recall.
So Billy Dee Williams lost to Scatman Crothers in The Shining. That award was going to a black man one way or another that year, apparently. Best Writing went to William Peter Blatty for the 9th configuration.
What?
Yeah, that's justified. Oh, well, okay, here we go. So the best music that year, Somewhere in Time, John Barry. So not a film that I recognise, but John Barry's fair enough.
Yeah, I do. It's a soppy romance movie with Jane Seymour and Christopher Reeve.
That has some element of sci-fi in it or fantasy.
Tiny bit,
kind.
Yeah.
Yeah, right.
Oh, time travel.
That's interesting. The costumes that year were Somewhere in Time as well. Jean-Pierre Dorliac.
No, I wouldn't think so.
Yeah.
He wore an amazing tie in that film. It was,
I don't know, Brose.
The other thing worth mentioning is Flash Gordon was released at the same time.
It was.
But got none of the spoils. None of the spoils. Flash Gordon's high point is probably its references in the first Ted film. But other than that,
I would have thought you'd love Flash Gordon.
No.
Really?
Not my cup of tea.
The Rotten Tomatoes website certifies Empire Strikes Back fresh with a score of 95%, 77 positive and only 4 negative, with a very good IMDb score as well, Brose, of 8.8 out of 10. Yeah, one of the highest ranking films I think we've looked at.
Yeah, it's well up there, definitely. Yeah.
The Empire Strikes Back received mixed reviews from critics upon its initial release. For example, Vincent Canby of the New York Times wrote a largely negative review. Judith Martin of the Washington Post criticized the film's middle-of-the-story plot, which she claimed had no particular beginning or end. However, this was a concept that Lucas has intended. So that's a really justified criticism right there, isn't it?
It's kind of funny, isn't it? This has no it has no real ending. That was the point. Okay, it's still shit then.
Unbelievable. In retrospect, fans and critics alike have widely come to consider The Empire Strikes Back to be the franchise's best film. Bob Stevens of the San Francisco Examiner described The Empire Strikes Back as the greatest episode of the Star Wars trilogy in 1997, and Andrew's favourite, Roger Ebert, described the film as the strongest and most thought-provoking film of the original trilogy.
Roger, he's
earning a few points back with you here, yeah. Andrew, a little bit.
Nice guy.
In 2010, the film was selected for preservation in the National Film Registry by the Library of Congress for being culturally, historically, and aesthetically significant. Darth Vader was ranked the 3rd greatest film villain of all time in the American Film Institute's 2003 list of the 100 greatest heroes and villains.
Who were the first two?
Yeah, that's what I want to know.
Hannibal Lecter was the first.
Okay.
And Norman Bates from Psycho.
Yeah.
Darth Vader. Number 4, The Wicked Witch of the West from Wizard of Oz.
Nice.
And Nurse Ratchet in at 5. Yeah. One for
the, Jason Voorhees didn't get a look in.
No,
he's hacked and slashed his way through.
Doesn't seem to be in the list at all.
Wizard magazine selected the ending of The Empire Strikes Back as the greatest cliffhanger of all time.
That's ridiculous.
And the most well-known line of The Empire Strikes Back.
No, I am your father.
Is often misquoted as Luke, I am your father. The line was selected as one of the 400 nominees for the American Film Institute's 100 Years, 100 Movie Quotes, and Yoda's pointed statement to Luke Skywalker, try not do or do not, there is no try, was also a nominee for the same list by the AFI. You're probably having a bit of trouble following that one.
We'll explain it. We'll put it in the right order later so you understand.
I'll re-edit it to make it sound different. The film was selected in 2010 to be preserved in the Library of Congress as part of its National Film Registry. It is unclear whether a copy of the 1980 theatrical version or the 1997 special edition has been archived by the NFR, or indeed if any copy has been provided by Lucasfilm and accepted by the registry. And in the 2014 Empire magazine list, the 300 greatest movies of all time, voted by fans, The Empire Strikes Back was named as the greatest film ever made.
Wow.
which is probably one of the most amazing little things that jumped off the page here at me. As much as I love this film, it's not the greatest film ever made.
What is? Let's be honest.
Back to the Future.
It didn't actually budget an inch there when that question came out. It was destined to be.
In my opinion, it is. And I can't believe we're doing it in a few weeks.
October, yeah,
well.
It's not far away. Back to the Future's coming.
There's a drum roll, isn't it, before that happens?
It's just insane.
Andrew, you're going to be there, my friend. You're going to be there.
And nail me down.
Let's wrap this up. Finally, this has been our most epic episode ever, bros. Let's wrap it up with our traditional 5-star review system per guest. Andrew.
Yeah, it's daunting, but we've just discussed so many of the reasons why this is a great film. It's the one I always go back to when I want to watch Star Wars. I can skip A New Hope and I can go to Empire Strikes Back and just watch that and be happy, because it just takes me back to being a kid. It's magical. It just takes you to different worlds, and just the story is fantastic, and the drama between the characters, the emotion in the storyline, you just get sucked into it again, and it's just so much talent in this film, and it all comes together in a perfect way. So, you know, for the reasons we discussed, the cinematography, the music, the production design is another great element of this film, and performances and direction. So, it's a definitely highly recommended film. Hey, Bros. He just played footsies with me under the table. Do you want me to say something?
I've been playing footsies with Mark all night.
That's true.
I've been non-responsive.
Turn the record over. I guess that's a wind-up for me from Brose. So,
I was stretching.
I'm going to give it 4.5. It's a great film.
Great. Thanks, Andrew. Brose.
Yeah, this is a challenge. I'm going to give it 4.5 as well. Star Wars, I think I gave 4, which I think is fair. And this one is definitely better than Star Wars. When I watched it this time, I watched it a few times, actually, in preparation for today, and I felt a little bit empty with the open ending, and I guess in a way I just got excited about watching Jedi again, and I'm really reevaluating my opinion of Jedi, and I think it's gone up in its esteem for me.
The Ewoks, right?
It's a lot to do.
They blink now.
You know, now that I don't get judged as much for being a furry, I just find it a lot easier to be open about my love for Ewoks. Just the open-endedness for this time around the film, I just found a little bit frustrating. Even though all those great elements are there, I don't think the characters are better realized in any other Star Wars film than they are in this film. Yoda, Han Solo, Leia, Mark Hamill's learned to act, Skywalker's amazing, Darth Vader comes into his own. If anything, C-3PO and R2 are the only two that kind of have a raw deal in this one. But all the other characters, this is the best example of them in cinema. So for that reason, and it's just epic, it's spectacular. The different landscapes are really nice. Hoth is such a great contrast then when we're back in space later on. Cloud City is stunning. It's 4.5 stars. It's a great film. Check it out.
Good stuff, Brose. Mark.
I think there's the three greatest sequel films I can think of. Aliens to Alien, correct, which is awesome. Toy Story 2 to Toy Story, the original, was outstanding. And Empire is that same thing for me. I'll give it 5 out of 5.
Two more films that get thrown in there a lot are Godfather Part 2.
Spectacular.
Disagree.
And Terminator 2.
Love it. Forgot about that.
Yeah. Yeah. So, sorry, what was your...
5.
I give it 5.
Oh, 5 stars.
5 stars.
I would add, though, it's one thing to sort of review a film, watch it on your TV, whatever. It's a movie to be watched in the cinema.
So you're waiting for the next re-release.
Yeah. Star Wars is always... They're cinema movies. They're great on Blu-ray, but you're not in a cinema. Fantastic.
Yeah, I saw A New Hope when it was re-released at the cinema, and it blew my mind.
So exciting. I mean,
but I didn't follow up with the
Star Destroyers on a big white... That
opening shot. It's so true, you forget that.
You have
that.
To be in a cinema.
Yeah, no, that's definitely worth... I mean, there are films like Back to the Future that I've gone back and seen in the cinema, and Ghostbusters that I'd never seen in the cinema, and... It's nice to remind people that films are made for a cinema, and it's great just to go. I'm sick of people telling me they don't like going to the movies. It's like, well, then you forget
missing half of
the
it.
Difference
yeah.
between seeing a film and enjoying the story and characters, and then adding back in that spectacle element of a film and it being on a massive side of a frigging wall and filling the whole space. The spectacle is underappreciated.
There's also something about the energy of going back to watch these classics with an audience of people who have seen the film.
And we've talked about that before.
A lot.
Yeah.
And the energy that they just have around them, because they are watching something they just love, is very, very different to watching a film with an audience for the first time as well.
Yeah. When I saw New Hope, took my brother, we always used to laugh about Luke and the power converters line. We used to make we giggle, but we thought it was something that we giggled about. Get to the cinema, you know, 200 people pissed themselves laughing. It was hilarious. Yeah. It was awesome.
Bigger, badder, bolder, darker. The Empire Strikes Back is fantastic. With all the world building and character establishment done in A New Hope, Empire takes the opportunity to build on these rock solid foundation and plunge our heroes into all sorts of chaos. And that's what we love about it. It's dark, sinister, but ultimately even more involving than A New Hope. The Empire Strikes Back defies viewer expectations and takes the series to heightened emotional levels. It almost becomes a thriller more than a fantasy in parts. It's Han's story, and he takes center stage here, and I don't think that anyone can have an issue with that. I also think that there's something really beautiful and simple and elegant about the way Yoda describes the Force to Luke, about how it surrounds us and binds us and how we're luminous beings. We're not made of crude matter. There's something about that that feels a lot more inclusive and kind of helps you kind of buy into it and helps you sort of fill in the blanks yourself, as opposed to the pedantic down to the details kind of description that Lucas felt necessary to do in the prequels. Yoda's description feels very powerful. We didn't need a description that we'd already accepted 34 years ago, George. And that's going to be my leeway into the prequels.
You're still dirty, aren't you? You're still dirty on it.
I can't imagine ever being...
And no, but it's a bold assumption that George Lucas listens to Real Chat, but an accurate one. We've had feedback. No, I don't know.
Wouldn't that be fantastic? We just heard something, even if it was a rebuttal against something that we said.
Because, you know, hearing it for the 400 millionth time from us is what's going to change his...
Yeah, it's exactly right. Oh, God, I'll just put out the original versions on Blu-ray then for them, shall I? I can't imagine ever being more entertained than I am during Episode 5. It was the greatest achievement in the world when I was a child, and over 30 years later, nothing has changed. What I really paid attention to this time around was the pacing. It's astonishing how perfect The Empire Strikes Back flows. Every single scene is exciting and memorable. I think it's the first film I ever saw that was a cliffhanger as well from when I was a kid. I remember it being very painful, but in the most satisfying way you can imagine. They've lost, and I have no idea what's going to happen next, but there was something really exciting about that and made you really, really look forward to the next one. If you're looking for what is just about the perfect sequel, found it, you have.
Now, let me explain that to you. No, I don't get it.
Okay. So on that, 4.5 stars and highly recommended from me. Yeah, this is my favorite Star Wars movie. So that pretty much wraps it up. But up next, we're actually going to do a special, Brose, with the recent passing of Wes Craven. We're going to have a look at his career.
Yeah, a bit of a retrospective on the great work that he did and the contributions he made, definitely.
So that's up next. And later in the year, we will be looking at Return of the Jedi and the 3 Star Wars prequels. They're going to be interesting. Mark, thank you so much for coming along today.
It's been a pleasure. We've had a good time. I have.
Talking Star Wars. But hopefully you'll come back and visit us again sometime.
I'd love to. Thank you.
Fantastic, mate. Brose, thank you.
No worries. Thank you, Andrew. Very much.
Thanks pleasure, a lot, guys. And we'll speak to you guys soon. Thank
May
you.
May the Force be with you. You can keep in touch with us here at Real Chat by visiting realchat.com.au. Check us out on Twitter at Real Chat Podcast, Instagram, real_chat_podcast. And we're on YouTube, Real Chat Podcast, surprise, surprise, and track us down on Facebook. You can hit iTunes for new episodes and check out some of our old episodes. Thanks for listening.